Great weak
by
side.
By Dylan Hurley.
Hurley with a great job of following up.
Tackmeyer's going to take the three. Nylon from him. Cade Tackmeyer turns and shoots an arrow into the crowd from Peshtigo, Wisconsin.
Grinnell wears those warm-up shirts. Three is better than two.
They live by that motto.
Yeah, Ripon just showed Cornell that.
Yep. Knocked away by Spielvogel. He's going to get on the floor for it. Galati's going to grab it.
They're going to call the foul.
It's going to be a loose ball foul on Jackson Herring. Connor Spielvogel sacrifices the body and gets the Redhawks the ball and draws a foul in the process.
Out of Pueblo, Colorado. They were in my conference. We used to play Pueblo East.
Rivals?
Not our rival, but we would drive 50 minutes to the south of Colorado Springs to Pueblo on Interstate 25.
Pueblo, that's a heck of a drive.
Pueblo Centennial,
yep.
Pueblo East, and Pueblo South.
A lot of recruiting from the west of America on Cornell.
And you see that at Knox and Beloit as well, out to Arizona and such.
And Grinnell, you just see an almost nationwide approach.
Yeah, it's a UN conference.
It is.
A UN enrollment.
United Nations over here.
Yep.
Cam Ford with a nice little spin move, puts it up, and it's going to roll in. Cam Ford with 2 points. And that's going to tie this ball game up at 14 with 7:05 left on the clock in the first half.
All of a sudden, those short shots are falling for the host team Redhawks.
And that's what you need. That's all you need. You just need the shots to start falling. Doesn't matter if it's a two or a three. Great defense up on the top by Galati on number 20, Charlie Robinson.
Yeah, make that guy with the ball uncomfortable.
Hurley goes up and rolls one in.
And Hurley's good against man-to-man pressure. He's shown that.
And that's going to be a timeout taken by the Cornell Rams by head coach Dave Schlaba on his seventh season as the head coach of these Rams.
Yeah, hey, what's going on? Do I got matchups today? I don't even know. Do I have matchups today? Maybe I do not. It's probably somewhere in our programs. I'll find it later. I can tell you this, that IC is still in first place with a 17-2 record. Ripon was idle earlier in the week on Tuesday. Everybody else played. So IC stayed with just the one loss to the Redhawks in conference. Grinnell's right behind them with an 8-2 record. Knox, 5-4. And Beloit 6-5. Who would have thought that third and fourth place you'd have 4 and 5 losses halfway through the more than halfway through the season? Monmouth is at 500. Ripon lost to them by one last time we carried you a game from Weiske Memorial Gymnasium. And then Cornell and Ripon, as we said in pregame, 3-6 in conference. And then bringing up the rear in the conference, Lake Forest with 3 wins. Lawrence University with 2 wins.
Both on the men's and women's side of the conference. It's going to be high drama on seeing who's going to make it into the MWC tournament.
Yeah, we'll talk more about matchups with 6 games to go for some of the teams follow after today's contest.
Spielvogel from a deep, deep area of the court. Nylon.
Yeah, and he just that one he didn't have to rush like some of the other catch and shoots. That was stepped into it. Had a nice release, nice arc.
That's really when you start seeing the Chris Mullen coming through. Good defense being played by Clark Cunningham over on number 22, Jaden Meeker, who's looking around for it. Spielvogel almost knocked it away. Oh, and a foul is going to be called on
Spielvogel.
Spielvogel got a little too much body on him.
So Ripon's gone down. They were at one point down, what, 12-4 maybe? Something
yep.
like that. And fought back now, a one-point lead.
With 5:57 left, shot out of the inbounds pass, and it's good from Zach Engel.
They're the scorers coming in as advertised, and they're delivering here today at Ripon.
Like we said earlier, Jaden Meeker averaging 18 points a game. Zach Engel right behind him with 16.
Bounce pass. It was a good pass. It just didn't handle it.
Yep.
And it's nice to get that bounce pass in there in that against that zone. That's why Galati used it.
Number 20, Charlie Robinson working it around. He's now going to give it to Jay Hurley, who misplayed it a little bit. Galati on him now. Charlie Robinson from the corner. Boy, airballs it.
What a great defensive sequence there for Ripon.
Indeed.
Great ball pressure.
Galati gets it up to Tackmeyer, looking for another option. Gives it to Meinholz, who's driving in. Kisses it in off the glass with the right hand. A beautiful step through from Luke Meinholz.
Dribble drive. Boom.
Has this Ripon crowd happy as can be right now with a one-point lead. Meeker with it at the top of the key, guarded by Meinholz very closely. Meinholz's anticipation that you had mentioned earlier, that's resulted in him with a team-high 52 steals.
Oh, it's his whole career. It's been that way since he stepped foot as a fresh deep three.
Spielvogel, nylon, again! Wow! Connor Spielvogel from the NCAA logo.
Yeah, who's he think he is, Caitlin Clark?
Maybe. Nah, Caitlin Clark thinks she's Connor Spielvogel. I'm sure the two have never met, probably. I don't know. Meeker got Meinholz on a fake and
pretty.
A nice little right-handed floater.
Yeah, it was. That's a shot that just, it wasn't around 10 years ago.
And then it was brought into popularity at the NBA level, and
yes,
then it trickled down.
Yeah.
The main perpetrators of that were John Wall, Steph Curry, James Harden. Meinholz goes up
no
with the right
ball.
Hand, no foul.
Wow.
Rebound to Ford. Tackmeyer from the corner. Nylon!
He's
Kate Tackmeyer turns
two.
To the Cornell bench. Gives him what for? 8 points now for Tackmeyer. Very balanced scoring effort by the Redhawks.
Yeah,
everyone on the floor right now with at least one basket.
It's a big possession here for both teams.
Meeker tried the turnaround, didn't work. Now to Engel.
The defense intensity right here for Ripon's been impressive.
It is. Pass taken away by Galati. He's coming up on the side. He's going to go up with the right hand. No good. Ford with the rebound behind him. And that one is good. Cam Ford with the putback.
Look
and another timeout by Cornell.
Both of Ripon's bigs followed him down there. And if they hadn't, it would have been no basket for Ripon.
Galati got a full head of steam, and he couldn't really slow down on the dribble. But he had Cam Ford right behind him to clean up his mess.
The thing that I'm used to seeing with Ripon is on defense is pretty good hawking the ball, right?
Yeah.
I'll see that no matter what point guard for Ripon's out there on defense. And then Meinholz has been doing what Meinholz has been doing probably since he was born. And his up-the-line denial, hitting passing lanes, you know, and steals, he always does that. But what I'm seeing the rest of the team intensity defensively in the half court. I'm seeing these other guys playing at a higher level than what I'm used to seeing as a collective group.
Oh, for sure. And now Ripon has fought back from a 6-point deficit at one point. Now they lead by 7 with 3 minutes to go in the first half. They've taken a commanding lead on this run that they are on right now.
Remember, it was just a hiccup ago, they were down 12-4. So they've turned the tables here. Basketball is a game of runs. Let's see if that timeout does anything for the Rams.
Zach Engel working it up on the top of the key for the
yep.
Rams.
And there's that denial. Fitch steps up, didn't allow the pass.
Meeker with a mid-range, no good air ball. That was a wild shot grabbed by Will Ryan.
Because Meinholz got in his grill.
Meinholz going fast. It's going to be a foul call. Meinholz is going to go to the line to shoot two.
They talk about how sometimes an offense can put pressure on a defense. You just saw it. That dribble drive against that zone, they were barely able, and up to this point, I think the Rams have done a good job getting back on missed shots by themselves and getting that zone set up, but not that time.
And that's one of those things that when you watch basketball, as Meinholz makes his first free throw, it's infuriating to watch when you make a turnover and then the person that makes the turnover doesn't hustle back.
Oh, yeah. You're talking about a pet peeve of mine, and I'm broadcasting a high school game.
Meinholz puts in his second one. He's 2 for 2. The first two free throws we've seen today, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Refs have been letting him play as of right now.
I don't think nobody until then for either team has attempted a free throw.
Jacobson working it. Almost a wild pass, but it was picked up by Hurley. Jacobson from the corner. Rims out, grabbed by Will Ryan.
And he's cooled off after making his first two to start the game.
His first eight points were the first 8 points of the game
yeah.
for the Rams. Tackmeyer fakes the three, takes his real one. Nylon!
He's made three straight unofficially.
Tackmeyer Another timeout taken by the Cornell Rams. Kate Tackmeyer is en fuego right now.
And Coach Slabod just showed his disappointment giving the referee that it's a full timeout. With that, Ripon's next game, we're going to be right back here Wednesday evening for another conference game, another important one. That's going to be against currently fourth place Beloit Buccaneers. That'll be a 5:30 start. Cornell's next game, you know, if they're fighting for their lives to get into the top four for the postseason tournament, they're going to they'll be at home, but they got to take on second place Grinnell, who's only got two conference losses on the year.
And for anyone who knows anything about college basketball, it's difficult to beat Grinnell whether you're playing at home or away. It's even more difficult on the road.
Yeah, so if Cornell, let's say, for example, and I'm not suggesting Ripon's going to win this game by any stretch today. It's too early.
Way too early.
If they lose today and then got to take the long bus ride home and then can't get over the top on Grinnell, that's going to spell big time, hard to get back into the top four.
They're swimming into the deep end right now is what you're saying.
Yeah, thank you. Well put.
Cornell's going to take the ball out here out of the timeout. Gives it to Meeker, who's going to walk it up the court. Schlappa yelling words of, can't tell if that's encouragement or not.
Let's see if that intensity by the Redhawks stays.
Engel from way downtown rims out. Wild shot.
Set play. It was a set play off the ball screen.
It was. Still doesn't look that good when it's the first shot you take from that deep out.
And you take
Meinholz.
And you take it early.
Meinholz with nothing but net.
Yeah, some people will tell you a bad shot selection is like a turnover.
Yeah. Meeker working it up the floor over the logo. Now he's looking for Jacobson, who takes a three. That's going to rim out.
That hit the retraction cable. Game should have been stopped.
Nate Jacobson and the rest of this Cornell squad.
There it is.
There's Meinholz. Goes in. Right-handed skyhook nylon.
He's so athletic that he buys himself time of going up strong with the ball, shooting the fade. High teardrop over the D.
And you love to see it. It's just such a smooth shot. That's kind of gone by the wayside in today's game of basketball.
And until this year, he was biding his time. His freshman, sophomore year was all about defense, contribution. Nice job. And averaging, definitely single digits his first two seasons. Oh, Spivogel, another deep three.
That kid can do nothing but shoot the lights out of the ball. And that's all he needs.
What a weapon to come off the bench.
That's my kind of shot, honestly.
That's interesting. The ref on the baseline, I don't believe, blew his whistle. The official out on top is the one that made the call. But like you said, hasn't been a lot of whistles unless they've been out of bounds calls.
32 seconds left in the first half. Ripon up by 17. A very complete half of basketball as Meeker makes his first free throw.
Coach Finko stayed very calm. You know, it was 12-4. We were on, then our 12-6. And all of a sudden, three started falling. Actually, before that, maybe some of the offensive putbacks down low did.
It did. That's been one of the keys as Meeker's second free throw rims out. That also looks like me on the free throw line. Was not a good shooter.
Thank God we didn't shoot free throws and pick up Moonball.
You've never played at the Y. Tackmeyer and Galati going back and forth. Ripon's going to probably wait to take the last shot of the half. They have enough of time. Meinholz looking. Galati fakes the three. Takes the three. Rims out. Fitch. Rebound. Goes up. No foul.
No call.
Chucks one the full length of the court. It's no good.
Boy, surprised no whistle on that.
That could have very easily been a whistle, but the refs probably didn't want to call a foul with 2 seconds left in the half.
Great job by Ripon after the first eight, nine minutes. Not a lot going on offensively, but that defense kind of stirred everything for them.
Yeah. So, at the end of the first half, Ripon leads 39-23 over the Cornell Rams. We'll be back in a while with stats from the first half, and we'll get on with the second half. You're watching Ripon Basketball on the Ripon College Network. Hello again, everybody, and welcome back to Ripon College Basketball on the Ripon Channel. If you're just joining us right now, you missed a good first half of basketball by the Ripon Redhawks. They lead the Cornell College Rams 39-23. And we're here now with some stats. First for the visiting Cornell College Rams. Leading scorer for them, Nate Jacobson, number 11, with 8 points on 3 of 8 shooting. And overall, it has not been a very good offensive first half. They started strong, but then they cooled off considerably. Their last 5 shots, I believe, did not go in to end the first half. But as for the Ripon College Redhawks, leading scorer for them, Cade Tackmeyer with 11, followed by Luke Meinholz with 10. Connor Spielvogel is shooting 3 of 6 from the field, but he is 3 of 3 from three-point land, 9 points. Cam Ford also with 4 points. But the real story here is the rebounding battle. Ripon College with 10 offensive rebounds to Cornell's 2 and 26 total rebounds to Cornell's 14. Martin, that's something that's going to lose you a game if you're Cornell.
That's it right there. And then you stir into that same recipe of success with the fact that the half-court defense, the way that they are ripping, are just really hawking the ball, going up the line, denying, and making it difficult. You have some nice dribble drive finishes by a couple of the guards for Cornell, but short of that, when you're not hitting the perimeter 3 and long 2.
And they're taking a lot of them.
And you got intense defense by Ripon. I mean, turnovers too, a stat I didn't think of looking at. Cornell has 6 turnovers to Ripon's 4, so it's not as bad as I would have thought. But steals, Ripon has 4 steals to just 1 steal by the Rams. So, yeah, the defense and the offense took a while to get on track for
Ripon. Yes, it did.
But,
and Luke Meinholz, you were finishing?
No, I was just going to say, man, it's a shame that the halftime buzzer had to go off, because when you get that momentum, you're going, if you're ripping, and thank goodness for the Rams of Cornell, they're going, thank goodness we can collect ourselves in the locker room and say, what do we got to do to get back to where we want to be?
And if you're head coach Dave Schlaba, you're telling your bigs and any one of your players that goes down low one thing: grab the ball when it doesn't go in the hoop.
And like I said, the hardest thing when you play zone is to box out and rebound, because it's not like, well, I got number 14, he's my guy, I'll make sure I get my backyard on him. No, you got to headhunt a purple jersey. There might be 2 right next to you, and you got to find one instantly, and hopefully it's not the same one that a teammate is, because that means someone's open on that offensive putback. So that's the challenge, statistically anyway, with going against zones. The nice thing about a zone, oftentimes if you're not hitting your shots from the perimeter like Ripon did with their downtown shooting with the 3-ball, if you're not hitting those, all of a sudden your offense does become quite anemic. But right now it's all Ripon, and so whether it's football or basketball, they always talk about how does each team always come out to start that second half.
The first half is crucial, but the second half is where games are won.
Yeah, so can Ripon maintain what they had going when they went into the locker room at halftime? Can Cornell find themselves and get back to where they were when they, as you said, started the game? Off to a really nice start where gentleman Jacobson, he had 8 points before you and I could barely get our headsets on. Yeah.
And we sure hope they can maintain it throughout the second half. And going back to what you were talking about, the steals, Meinholz came into this game with a team-leading 52 steals on the season. He's added 2 more to that total today.
Yeah, and it's safe to say we can probably assume there'll be another few before this contest is over.
Oh, 100%.
Ripon's Cornell, back with their starters.
Cornell's going to start with the ball in the second half. That's going to be Zach Ingles working it up there. Zach Ingle, my bad. Dylan Hurley driving to the right, getting downhill, almost lost it. He's going to go up with it on Tackmeyer. A wild shot. Oh, and a foul called on Cade Tackmeyer. So Dylan Hurley is going to go to the line.
Yeah. That kind of a late whistle. But
yeah, it was.
Yeah, but he called that. It's interesting because that ref is the one right in front of the Cornell coach.
Yep.
And
I
thought the Monmouth coach did a great job of working the refs in that 1-point loss that Ripon had to the Fighting Scots I think it was a week ago today, actually. So we'll see. Are the refs going to tighten up the game? We'll find out. There weren't a lot of fouls called in the first half.
Galati bringing it fast up down the court. Holds it up, gives it back to Tackmeyer, back to Galati. Meinholz at the elbow, working for a shot. Crossover, turnaround fade. No good, it was too short. And Wallace Schmotzer lets it go out of bounds.
The ball movement's been crisp all pretty much the entire game so far for Ripon, and getting that ball to the center of the lane against the zone. Cunningham hawking that ball on top.
Tackmeyer now on Hurley. Three from the corner from Ingle. Rims out, grabbed a rebound by Schmotzer. Ingle goes back up for two. The layup is good.
So early on, it's Cornell with the points.
Those are the first 2 points of the second half. Now Tackmeyer looking, gets Galati back to Tackmeyer. Just working it back and forth. Now Tackmeyer had an open three, thought about it. Now takes one. No good. Rebounded by Meinholz. A long rebound. Tackmeyer's going to take another three. No good again. So 0 for 2 on one possession from Cade Tackmeyer from three-point land. Cunningham is just all over number 5, Zach Ingle, up there on the top. Meeker driving the downhill to the right. A little hesitation.
Lost
move.
His balance, actually.
Yeah.
It looked like he was going to travel with it, and he was able to maintain possession with a nice finish off the window.
Cunningham looking around. Now Meinholz up at the top of the key. Over to Galati. Thought about a three. No good. Behind the back, gets it to Tackmeyer. Tackmeyer's going to go to work. Now passes one out to Meinholz out there on the three-point line. 8 seconds left. Cunningham, nice little reverse layup.
The Illinois product, nice drive on that baseline. You're right. You know, people like those reverse layups. They look cool, but they're using the rim as a defender. Nice job.
Cunningham, you said Illinois product out of Cary Grove High School in the same conference as the school that my dad coaches at, or used to coach at, I should say. Huntley High School, Fox Valley Conference.
Beautiful use of the window again by, that was Jacobson.
Yeah, Jacobson, maybe he finds his rhythm again. Hope not for Ripon's sake. Gets it into Slim Williams. Slim going to work. Knocked out of his hands, no foul.
Lost
ball
the
was
handle.
Loose.
Yep. He's struggling today.
Williams, I think, wanted a call there, but Williams was 0 for 5 in the first half.
Yeah, he's struggling.
Not something we're accustomed to seeing. Knocked away. It's going to be out of bounds on Williams, but a good job of stripping it away. Cam Ford is going to come in and replace Williams right away. Williams is not happy. You can see it in his body language.
No, you're not playing well. The ball's not falling for you. Galati, watch him when he's guarding his guy. Look who he's got him on, too, Jacobson.
Galati has the ability to go guard a guy who's got the momentum right now, and he shuts him down. Meeker from three, no good. Rebound to Schmotzer. Jacobson for three, no good again. Rebound to Cunningham. He's going to run the floor. He's looking for Galati. Gets it to him. Three-pointer from Galati. No good. Cam Ford, rebound, throws it off. Nope, he stepped out first.
Yeah. Wow, a lot of action. No scoring. You're going to get a quick 30-second timeout. Coach Finkel of the Redhawks wants to talk to his crew out there.
And it's something you got to do. You got to calm them down. You got to slow the motion of the game. The way the Redhawks got the lead they had in the first half was they were playing their game and they were allowing Cornell to play into their hands.
I like the timeout right now.
Yes.
You can look up and say, hey, Ripon's got the double-digit lead. Nah, it's deeper than that. You see the momentum, the way it shifted since halftime. He wants to get his guys to collect themselves, go back to doing what they were doing.
So far, Ripon outscored in the second half, 6-2.
They're playing a little rushed now on the offensive side of things. And Cornell is scoring. I mean, their shots are going up. They're going in. So
it also seems like they're looking for more focused, concentrated shots, Cornell. In the first half, there are a lot of wild three-pointers being chucked up by the Rams. Now it seems like they're just holding their time, waiting for the right shot instead of taking the shot.
Yeah, Coach Finkel talking to the official. Not sure about what.
Meeker picked up his dribble, now gets it over to Jacobson. Now Ingle, guarded by Tackmeyer. He threw one up, and
pretty
it's nylon.
Pretty
nylon
shot
from the elbow.
And that was with Meinholz behind him.
Yeah, and a hand in his face from Tackmeyer. Spielvogel back into the game now for the Redhawks.
Big possession for Ripon. They want to maintain double-digit lead. That's always a psychological thing.
Tackmeyer getting grabbed a little bit. No foul. They are letting them play out there. 8 seconds left on the shot clock. Tackmeyer down low to Ford. Ford working on it. He's got to put one up. Oh, and it rims out. He had one right there, and it just didn't fall.
Ford did a nice job of calm under fire against the double team.
Had a couple of spin moves to work with. Meeker shot from in front of the free throw line. Nylon again.
Yeah, it looks like a Meinhold shot.
The Rams are coming back. Hope they can't.
It's now single digits, just like that. At one point, it was a 17-point lead. That is now down.
And you can see that. You can see that Dylan Hurley, who is on Connor Spielvogel, is keeping him in his sights at all times, because if Spielvogel gets away from his defender and catches one wide open, he's going to let it fly. Meinholz from the free throw line, Nylon.
And his defender fell off of him at the 15-foot stripe because he didn't want a blow-by by Meinholz, so Meinholz said, okay, I'll drop the 15-footer.
And Meinholz's 15-footer should be sent to the patent office. He's made such a career out of it. Driving, Hurley, no good. Rebound back to him. He almost jumped over someone to get that one. It's going to be a jump ball, and it's going to go to Ripon.
William Ryan coming in for Galati. Ford's also going to take a seat. And Spivogel, your buddy, also on the court for the Redhawks.
Meinholz over to Spielvogel. Gets it down low to number 32, Cam Ford, going to work. Up and in with the right hand, a little reverse move.
Nice soft hands by the big kid from Athens, Wisconsin.
6 points for the 6'6" forward. Jacobson left wide open and he can't capitalize on the shot. Meinholz is gonna run the floor. He's working it up. Gonna give it to Tackmeyer. Thought about a three, doesn't take it. Tackmeyer throws up the floater with the right hand.
Cornell, talk about pressure with your offense on the defense. They could not set their zone because they had to stop the ball. And Tackmeyer knew it, did a great job of the finish.
And that's what Tackmeyer does when he gets down low, and he's, as he just runs through a screen from number 35, Noah Williams. Noah Williams has a nice mullet flowing. Just something I noticed. Meeker, a wild shot. It's going to be grabbed by Meinholz.
Oh, this
he's on the
fun.
Breakaway. Maybe. Yes, sir. He puts one in up off the glass. Kissed it in. Just
great job by the Marquette University high school grad. Nice job.
Will Ryan hounding Nate Jacobson up on top. Meeker guarded by Meinholz. Over to Hurley, guarded by Spielvogel.
Hurley very strong. With the ball.
Ford knocked it away.
Yeah, I like Hurley's game with the ball. He's problematic for the Ripon defense when he's down in the paint.
Definitely.
Tackmeyer comes out. And that'd be Cunningham came in for Tackmeyer as there's the jump shot, the long deuce.
From Zach Engel out of Washington. Just not a state you see a lot of products from out here, at least. Will Ryan gets it
nice
to Meinholz.
Passing.
Now to the corner. Cunningham! Short. Meinholz with the rebound.
Reload. Boy, was that great passing inside
it
out.
It was. Cam Ford found the open dude. Spielvogel, quick one. Oh, my. The quickest release of the day from Connor Spielvogel, and it almost went in.
Yeah, it reminds me of Ersegin for the Badgers. Catch and shoot.
Yeah, Mr. Basketball in Indiana right before he committed to Wisconsin. Hurley gets it over to Engel in the corner. Cunningham, great on-ball defense over there. Now Spielvogel just hounding him.
And a double.
Stripped away by Cam Ford, and he falls down. Now he's going to get it up to Will Ryan. Now Spielvogel bringing it up the floor. Gives it to Meinholz. Spielvogel open. Three. Nylon! He turned around before it was even in the basket.
We talked about converting turnovers, and a great job by Ford. When he saw that the guard for Cornell had his back to the rim, he doubled. Great
job. Exactly. And that's just spill. Oh, Meinholz with the steal. Throws it down with two hands. And a timeout, a full timeout to the Cornell Rams. Meinholz raises the roof on the Wilmore Center.
We're going to break away here. I got to collect myself. We'll be right back as Ripon gets the momentum right back.
And we're back. Ripon with a 19-point lead now with 11:52 left in the second half of this ball game over Cornell. A strong run that was just capped off by a Luke Meinholz two-handed slam on the other end.
You know, and it was just a moment ago I said they got it down to single digits, Cornell, with that deficit.
Ripon took the momentum right back, and it doesn't look like it's going to be something they're going to let go of.
That was a set play right there for a three, and Spielvogel took it away.
Three from the corner is going to be short. Rebound to Tackmeyer. Cunningham running the floor wanted one, but Tackmeyer didn't give it to him.
Yeah, they're back to that. It's a 2-3.
Yep. The classic 2-3 zone.
Yeah.
Spielvogel thought about a three. Had Engel in the air, but decided to pass it up. Jaden Fitch in the lane. Right-handed skyhook. Rolls one into the basket.
Once again, nice patience by the big. I think Ford's done a good job of that as well, and now Fitch follows suit.
And you can see the satisfaction on Coach Kenny Finko's face from all the way up here. He knows that this is the best run his team's gone on in a while.
Boy, that defensive intensity is back there again.
Hurley, nothing but net in the wrong way.
Yeah, outside of the net.
Spielvogel, three, nylon!
Oh, Coach Slaba's thinking, well, I only got so many timeouts. And boy, is he shouting on to his guys to get back.
Connor Spielvogel is on fire.
And it's the defense on these guys, I'm telling you.
He had a hand in his face and he still hit it. That's going to be a foul on Meinholz, I believe, or Tackmeyer.
Actually, I want to say Cunningham.
Could be Cunningham, yes.
And the jump shot. And,
it was Spielvogel.
He just got all charged up on the little mid 8-foot jumper, 10-foot jumper, and reached in, and he didn't have to. Generally, the cardinal rule is generally you don't want to foul a jump shot, per se.
Yeah.
But certainly challenged it, and he made it too easy for the official to blow the whistle when he...
Meinholz is going to come in for the game again. Meinholz is going to come into the game again for Cunningham.
Yep.
And now Ripon has maybe their best offensive unit on the floor right now, other than Colby Williams, who is on the bench with a rough game so far.
Yep.
Hopefully, if he gets in again, he can turn it around, get a couple of points on the board. But other than that, Connor Spielvogel, I believe, might be the leading scorer now. He's at 15. Just cannot miss from beyond the arc. Meinholz looking. Finds Tackmeyer. Thought about one. Now Spielvogel. Oh, my. I thought he was going to shoot that one.
Wow. He closed out in a hurry, and you can imagine what Coach Slaba has been saying.
Will Ryan crosses him over. Almost hits it. Rebound to Fitch. 20 left on the clock. Oh, he went up for the dunk, and he got stuffed.
Yeah. Weak side rotation. Stuffed him. Nice job defensively. That was Herring.
Engel from three. Nylon.
There stops some temporary
and another timeout that cuts the lead to 20.
Yeah, it doesn't. Yeah, and Coach Slaba gets it. Hey, it doesn't. you know, I'm
There's
down
not
big.
Much
I can't.
Can do.
Yeah, I got to see if we can stop it with some timeouts and quell the double digit deficit and that hot shooting ripping ball club right now. And so it doesn't do any good to save those timeouts to the end when the game's out of reach. We have the women's game coming up right after this contest. Ripon women, of course, a pristine 9-0 in conference action, taking on a Cornell team that I was sharing with you before we went on the air. 10 days ago, Cornell women were 6-1, one conference loss with a two-game lead over the next nearest opponent in the Midwest Conference. Since then, they have lost a game by 4 points, and then they went on a 20, as memory serves me, in the fourth quarter, they were down double digits, went on a 20-7 run to take the game into overtime, only to lose into overtime.
And that's
now,
sucks.
And now, yeah, and now they come in to a hornet's nest with Doc Weiske Gymnasium here with the queen of the conference.
Lauren Busalaki.
Yeah, and she's going to be going against these two are the Coach Brassi we'll talk about later as we get into that game. And he definitely is a senior coach in the Midwest Conference for women's basketball.
Ripon working it around. Will Ryan up at the top now.
Yeah.
Crossover, looking to his left. Spielvogel thought about it.
Well, good defense.
Oh, my. Spielvogel wants to shoot it. You can just see it in his eyes.
Oh, what a pass.
Oh, great pass to Fitch, but he can't hold on to it. Oh, and it rolls out.
Great dish by Ryan, wasn't that?
Yeah.
Just got a finish.
Meeker over in the corner. Drives baseline. He tries to. That's going to be a blocking foul on Luke Meinholz. I thought there was a little bit of a forearm contact.
That's my comment. At the initial, when he put it on the floor, the initial left arm, forearm, could have been called offensive. No whistle there. And then when it got pinched off on the baseline, it forced the official to make a call. He went with the block on Meinholz. His first, which is hard to believe. Another miss on the inbounds play.
You say it's hard to believe. In some ways, it's not. The refs have been letting him play all day,
yeah.
Really.
Right. I'm just stuck. I just look at generally, I look at Meinholz's style of defense and to stay out of foul trouble. But you're right. It's been very sparse whistles today.
And that's the way I like to watch basketball. I don't want to see someone shooting 20 free throws a game
right.
Like LeBron James.
Yeah. Now, coming off that timeout, Williams is back in for the Redhawks.
Slim looking to get something going. They get it right to him. It's going to go out of bounds off of Schmotzer, I believe. But it's going to stay ripping basketball as Nate Jacobson's checked in again. Heading out is Ben Kamak for the Cornell Rams.
Yeah, no surprise there, Coach Slabas. Got to get Jacobson.
Spielvogel,
look
three.
At
oh, we almost had a four-point play. It was fouled on the shot by Dylan Hurley. That would have been something else.
Wow, wow, wow.
But Spielvogel will now have three chances at the line to see if he can capitalize.
Always wonder if guys like him should stand at the three-point line and shoot their free throw.
Nah. Interesting
a little
thought.
A little bit of sarcasm there.
Interesting thought, but.
Nah, it wasn't meant to be taken seriously.
I'm sure someone has thought of it seriously before.
Yeah. Well, especially, though, the good three-point shooter that can't hit a free throw, you know, like, you know, if they fell out of a boat, they could hit water.
Yeah. Oh, Spielvogel almost had all three. It's going to go the other way.
I don't get that.
I don't either.
Williams is as surprised as you and me.
You can see it in his eyes. There were two Cornell players compared to just one Williams.
Yeah. Here we go.
Hurley with the ball up the top.
Back
nice
door.
Little oh, my.
Challenge by Williams.
Jaden Meeker almost brought the tomahawk down, and Colby Williams might have just saved himself from potential disaster as a wild pass by Spielvogel goes out of bounds, almost hits a photographer.
Yeah, what happened there? He was throwing his entry pass to the block, and Williams was starting to go down the baseline.
Exactly.
And to clear it out, and that happens.
A 22-point lead with 8 minutes left in this game for the Redhawks. And Connor Spielvogel, who's guarding Dylan Hurley right now, is one of the main reasons. Knocked away by Meinholz, but picked right back up by Meeker. Goes up. It's going to roll in.
Nice finish there on the curl move.
And right now, number five, Zach Engel, is staying with Kate Tackmeyer the whole length of the floor. A weird decision by Coach Slabaugh to have Tackmeyer be the focus of a full court guarding.
Yeah.
Tackmeyer has 13 on the day, but Spielvogel has 7. Colby Williams, first 2 points of the game as he flexes on Wallace Schmatzer. That's got to feel good for Williams. The kid from New Orleans now staring down Schmatzer. The big easy from way downtown. No good, Galati.
Great
over to Tackmeyer. With the left hand, no foul. Williams rebound. Gets on the floor, grabbed right out of his hands. And Tackmeyer is down on the floor. He is hurt. That's going to be an and one for Jaden Meeker. But on the other side of the floor, Cade Tackmeyer's hurt, and it looks like it might be his ankle.
Yeah, and that's been a chronic issue with him since he's been a freshman, since his freshman year. I remember former coach Ryan Kane had him penciled in as a freshman starting at guard. And he could have been but a couple of games into the season, and that was his ankle for quite a few games. And ever since then, it's been an issue.
Tackmeyer walked on his own power off the floor. Now he's behind the bench receiving treatment from the training staff here at Ripon College. I mean, if there's a time for a player to go down, it's when you have a 20-point lead in the second half, but you never want to see someone get hurt.
Well, we didn't see what happened. We were watching the ball with Williams, unless you did, and
the only thing I saw was him go into the wall, so maybe he landed weirdly when he went into the wall after that free throw.
Ripon with a 20-point lead here. Make that 19, but just basically 7 minutes left. And
that's going to be a timeout for the Redhawks.
Coach Finko on that timeout. Man, now coming off that last timeout, we got Galati back into the game along with Williams.
Yeah.
Like you said, Williams finally got his first points of the day on that left hand off the glass. I think if there's an area that I know just from watching today, it's the bigs got to be more consistent at finishing around the rim. But I think everything else is looking good. I think collectively, defensively for the Redhawks, I think it's been a really good effort today as a group. It's one thing to have a Meinholz and a William Ryan and a Galati or what have you playing good defense. But everyone's buying in on the defensive end of things today, and I think it's really made it difficult for Cornell. And then the other thing that we talked about right out of the gate to start the game, Ripon attacked that zone wonderfully. They got the ball to the middle, got it to the lane, inside-outside game, got open shots, and getting offensive rebounds that you mentioned at halftime, a stat that Ripon had a lot more offensive rebounds, I think like 10 or something.
10 or so.
And they couldn't finish the deal. They couldn't take advantage of those putbacks.
Yeah,
and
it's something you have to do in order to win ball games.
Yeah, especially when you're chasing the way Ripon is, because today they come in with Cornell tied for sixth spot, and it's everyone's going to be climbing up over each other's backs now, fighting for that third and fourth position to make it to that postseason play. Back in action here.
Yeah.
It's Galati, Williams, Meinholz, Spielvogel.
Back to Williams. Turns to the left. Throws one up. No foul again. And the entire Ripon bench is calling for one. And Williams is visibly frustrated.
Noah Williams on Williams did a nice job challenging the shot. Kicks it out for a three. And we're going to get a whistle and a chance for a four-point play. Rumbled around. Then it fell. Spielvogel, who was the recipient of being fouled on a three, is now the victim of fouling on a three, and we are going to see opportunity here for Jaden Meeker, one of the better scorers for Cornell.
Meeker
to complete
has taken
the four-point play.
Yeah, Meeker has taken all of Cornell's free throws as of this point, as he just now completes the four-point play. Meinholz bringing it up for the Ripon Redhawks over to Cunningham.
Let's see if they work some shot clock here.
Yeah.
Huh?
Nope, Williams is going to take it. Rebound. Williams back to himself. Williams working hard. And puts it in. I think Williams wanted to dunk it, but it went up out of his hands too quick.
Good job there of pivoting, pivoting under the pressure.
Yeah. Hurley working on it. Almost got it picked off by Meinholz.
Meinholz just the
Just long arms. He's getting on everything. Nylon from Jaden Meeker.
His attitude, his defensive attitude. You just wish you could bottle it and give it to your teammates.
Yes, you do. Jaden Fitch looking to check into the game for the Redhawks. Spielvogel looking around, trying to find an open man. He finds Cunningham. Cunningham driving to the left. Now working. Galati thought about a three. No. Crossover. Thinking. Again. Yeah.
They're working some clock here.
7 seconds left on the shot clock. Spielvogel thinking about it. Gives it back to Cunningham. He's got to put one up. No. Oh, and it's going to be a foul on, I don't know if that was Williams. It's
probably Williams, because I think Galati left before he blew the whistle. Let's see.
Yep, it's on Williams. And the surprising part is Connor Spielvogel, I believe, has the most fouls on the Redhawks. He's got 3 fouls right now as he gets checked out. Tackmeyer and I believe it's Fitch come in to replace the two of them.
Yeah, he's challenging some jump shots and getting called for.
Yep. Which I guess you can't complain about that. It's good defense. Meinholz just in this grill at all times. Nice backdoor cut.
You can't get caught watching the ball. You can't be ball watching. You got to head.
You got to have an eye on the ball and
on,
your man.
Ball man. Heads on a swivel, as the old coaching drills would be. Step back.
Tackmeyer, step back from the baseline. It's short. Grabbed by Fitch.
Good
Meinholz.
Move.
Tipped away right to Fitch. It was damn near an assist. Oh, and it rolls out.
All of a sudden, everything that Ripon to start the game when nothing would fall on offensive rebounds, it's kind of happening
Cornell
again.
Cornell has cut it back to a 13-point game. Still have a ways to go. That's number 21, Julian Cleary out of McKinney, Texas.
Yeah, this game's not over.
No, not by any means.
You know, they drop a three here, for example, or anything, any type of a score here.
They cut it back to a 10-point lead.
Cleary thought there it is.
What on a blocking foul. And the whole crowd, home crowd, home bench, does not agree with that. Galati might have to be careful. Doesn't want to say anything that could get him teed up. Galati plays with a fiery personality, and I'd imagine that showed through in an argument with the ref.
Yeah, kid out of Chicago, literally Chicago, Chicago, Illinois.
St. Patrick High School.
Yeah. So it stops the clock, which is great for Cornell. Gives them a chance to get points, which is good for Cornell.
Williams is going to be checked back into the game for Jaden Fitch. My bad.
Going to see if Williams has found some, collect himself and finish better around the rim here, the way things didn't go his way to in the first half offensively. But
Meeker's
also
first.
He's a nice challenge. I'm sorry, Crete. He's also a nice job defensively, right? I mean, he's going to jump out of the gym, get the hands in the shooter's face.
Kobe Williams earlier staved off near disaster when he almost got a tomahawk thrown down on him.
Yeah, I remember that. Both men got up quite high there on that exchange.
That would have been one of the more impressive things I've seen in person on a basketball floor.
Yeah.
Dom Galati going to work. Kind of gets it kicked away from him, but he retains possession. Now Meinholz working. Goes to the right. Goes to the left. Think about it. Gives it to Williams. Williams down low. Oh, he went up, and he's fouled. I don't know what the call is.
Well, Williams got fouled, so they're going to give him 2. I think the officials, you know, they didn't call anything for the most part in the first half. And now it's a different kind of game here in the second half.
Williams is going to go to the line for the first time today with an opportunity to add to this Red Hawk lead that is currently at 12 points as the first one hits the back of the rim and bounces out. Williams, the 6'7" forward out of Northfield, Illinois.
Spielvogel comes in for Cunningham for the Redhawks. 3:39 remaining
Actually, that's my mistake. He is not out of Northfield, Illinois. He's out of New Orleans, Louisiana. The scoreboard is wrong.
Here we go.
Cleary with the ball up on top. Gives it over to Hurley, who's guarded up at the top now by Williams. That's not something you usually see. Williams got to be careful here. Williams has got to be careful. Meinholz really affected
challenge.
The shot. Really affected it.
He
did not block
bothered.
It. Yeah. Didn't block it, but he definitely, all the pass gets away. On the floor, everyone's diving. It's going to be out of bounds on Cornell. It's going to stay Ripon's basketball. Holy cow, that was chaos for a second.
Yeah, it wasn't a good pass, and that's what set up the whole chaos is a good word for that exchange. So we'll get a timeout called.
Chaos, tumult, I don't know. We'll step away for a second here. We're going to retain, collect our thoughts, be ready to give you the final 3 minutes and 12 seconds of this action. All right, and we're back with Galati bringing it into inside to Williams. Williams working on it, right hand, goes up. No foul, no bucket. Throwing the deep pass, Jacobson.
Ooh, pretty.
Nice move by Jacobson. Smooth. Threw it up behind him with the right Smooth. Hand. And that cuts this deficit now to 10. With 2:45 left, this is still anyone's basketball game.
Oh yeah. Ripon's got to take care of the ball, be strong with the ball.
As right I say as that. You say that. Knock on wood every
Fortunate
time.
There. Strong with the ball and
can't
then get
catch
a good shot.
Right now you can't catch it with the fingertips. You got to catch it with the palm.
I was kind of surprised when there was 7 minutes left that Ripon wasn't looking at working the clock a little bit. They kept attacking.
They also early. Weren't really playing with the urgency of someone trying to put a team away. Tagmeyer from the elbow.
Difficult
no
shot.
Good. That's going to be out. Oh! Everyone on the Ripon bench was
go.
Asking for it to be Ripon basketball.
Ripon's got to play that defense. Now you do not want to be you don't want to be fouling here to stop the clock and let him get send him
Cornell,
to the line.
Cornell is in the bonus right now. Fitch, great defense. Grabbed. Oh, and he missed it. It's going to be out of bounds. It's going to go over to the Ripon.
He tried to bounce it off of him and it couldn't hit him. And
I'm scatterbrained
great
right
save.
Now.
Great save. By Galati to get out of the way, out of bounds. Now we're going to see a little bit of backcourt. Now they're going to back off that pressure.
Julian Cleary is going to be tasked with guarding the quick, small, agile Dom Galati. Meinholz with the ball now. Gives it to Galati.
Here we are, strong with the ball. They got to come out too on Ripon.
Now Tackmeyer backing down number 11, Jacobson. Throws one up with a right hand, grabs his own rebound.
Get it on top.
Spielvogel. Looking for it, thought about a three, didn't take it. Meinholz, 15 left on the clock. And a foul is going to be called on Cleary.
If you've noticed, Spielvogel has not attempted a three-point shot in a while. And the reason is because Hurley is doing a heck of a job
yes,
on him.
Yes, he is.
And he's not letting him get uncoiled on a catch and shoot.
Those fakes are not purposeful fakes. Those fakes are, I'm trying to shoot the ball and he's just on me too well.
Yeah, he's crowding him.
A guy like Spielvogel does not purposely fake a shot. He's going to take whatever he wants. Meinholz throws it down with two hands what with authority.
What a beautiful inbounds
wow.
play.
Meinholz went streaking to the basket as Jacobson from way downtown, from the Bob Gillespie logo. And that's going to be a foul by Cleary on Galati in the corner. That's a 9-point game now. Between the Redhawks and the Rams.
Three possessions, 80 seconds.
This game is still not over.
He's going to go with defense now. Looks like Schlaba's going to be.
It's going to be Trey Totherow.
Yep. So they got to go belly button to belly button, man-to-man defense here.
it's going to be Julian Cleary, Jaden Meeker, Jackson Herring, Trey Tothero, and number 12, Ben Kamak. And another foul by Cleary.
They got
fouls to give, yes.
Because they got to get to the bonus. It's going to come down to eventually here if Ripon can get to the free throw line. They're going to probably foul early. Go for the steal and then foul if you can't steal.
Galati almost had that pass taken away, and now another foul. And now Ripon is in the bonus.
With a 9-point lead, you'd like to think Ripon's in good position, and they are.
Still a minute 16 left in the game, though.
But a couple of steals, a couple of three balls. Next thing you know, you're fighting for your life. So
This has been what we said it would be, a good, evenly matched game as of right now. Every time someone's gone on a run, the other team has matched it. Maybe not to the same extent, but they've then gone on a run of their own. As Galati shoots his first free throw, nylon.
Women's basketball, after a short break, will be our second of two games this afternoon. Second place Cornell will be taking on the first place Lady Redhawks of Ripon. But we got to finish this one,
yep.
Crete.
Galati working on it. Meeker. That's going to be Engel from three. Rims out. Grabbed by Meinholz. Gets back. Oh, and a ticky-tack call.
Yeah.
The Redhawks had that fast break all primed up.
Cornell took it away from them. They said, we're going to foul.
And I didn't even see a real contact. I think that was just the ref making a call.
Realizing the strategy of the visitors. Well, I like to think now with 57 seconds, 69-58 Ripon, the men are going to put themselves in a position here with four conference wins to go to 4-6 overall.
As Meinholz puts in his first free throw.
You know the teams that are ahead of Ripon right now, Monmouth at 5-5, they got a tough row to hoe coming up. We'll talk about that in a moment.
Great challenge by Jaden Fitch on Dylan Hurley.
Yeah, he walled up and stayed straight up. So he didn't let the ref a chance to blow his whistle.
And right now, it seems like Cornell's realizing that this ball game's going to be over. Still not enough time on the shot clock to just run it out, but they're just going to give it to him. Galati's going to work on it. Gives it down low to Tackmeyer. Knocked away. On the floor is Hurley. And that's probably going to be the game. Wow, a wild chuck up of a shot by Jacobson.
That'll
and the Redhawks are going to dribble it out. That's going to be the final as the horn draws near to near. The Redhawks are going to win this game 70-58 over Cornell. Leading scorer, I believe, is Luke Meinholz with 19. Connor Spielvogel also added a solid effort with 17 of his own. As for Cornell, 25 points from number 22, Jaden Meeker. But it was not enough as the Ripon Redhawks win this game by 12 and move to 4-6 in Midwest Conference play and 6-13 overall.
Yeah, they're still in the hunt, Crete, because now we're going to be back up here Wednesday and fourth place Beloit comes in to take on Ripon. And then Ripon gets to play third place Knox, also at home. So they're going to be able to control their own destiny with regards to that. Then guess where they got to go? They got to go to Cornell. And then they'll finish up their last home game of the year will be on Valentine's Day, the 14th. And that'll be against 8th place Lake Forest and then finish up with a rival Lawrence University. So that is huge for Ripon. Meanwhile, the teams, particularly I look at Monmouth that's ahead of Ripon. Monmouth has to go, they have to play Knox. They have to go to Illinois College. Good luck with that. Then they got to play third place Knox in Knox's house. Play Ripon again, as we mentioned, and then they're at Cornell, and then they go to Grinnell. I'm telling you, Ripon to play third and fourth place Knox and Beloit at home right away here in their next two games, and then look at what Monmouth has to do, and I know what Cornell has to do. They got to play second, fourth, third, fifth, and ninth place teams. So who knows? Stranger things have happened. But what a nice, impressive double-digit win today by the Redhawks.
Indeed. We thank you for joining us here on the Ripon Channel.
Yeah.
This has been Ripon College men's basketball. We hope you will join us again in a couple of minutes for the women's game. That'll be on shortly. But for now, I'm Crete Slattery, joined by Martin Ernser.
Yep.
Signing off.
Yep.
We thank you for joining us. Hello again, everybody, and welcome back to Ripon College Basketball on the Ripon Channel. Today we have another intriguing matchup between Ripon College, the Lady Redhawks, and the Cornell College Lady Rams. I'm Crete Slattery, and I'm joined by Martin Ernser. Martin, how are you doing today?
Hey, I'm doing well, especially since we're halfway through today's doubleheader, and the good guys, the ones that we cheer for anyway, the men Redhawk, really did one of the better jobs of putting a whole game together, a whole 40 minutes, yes. And came out double-digit victors.
Yes, that was a great game. I hope you stayed with us throughout the whole day. If you got a chance to see that, I'm glad. You'll get a chance to see yet another good game today between the Ripon Redhawks and the Cornell Rams. Ripon College women's team, 12-6 overall, and a pristine 9-0 in Midwest Conference play, looking to capture, what is it, their sixth consecutive Midwest championship?
That is just nuts. That is just crazy to think that, but yeah, that's correct. And then Cornell comes in today in second place, so Ripon will definitely be tested today.
And you were talking earlier on air about how Cornell's college team seems to be on the verge of falling apart at this moment.
Well, yeah, I mean, call it what you will, they were 6-1 10 days ago. They're now 6-3. They lost a game by 4 points and then a double or overtime loss to Illinois College. So it's been rough sledding here, but now they got to focus. And Coach Brassey, if anybody can do it, it's him. He makes me nervous. This guy is very good. He's pretty much the dean of women's coaching in Midwest Conference.
19 years he's been at the head of this Cornell team.
Yep.
Of course, head coach Lauren Busalaki on the Ripon side, her 11th season. One of the winningest coaches in Ripon College history, at least on the ladies' side.
Yeah, we'll talk about some of those numbers. I did have a chance to talk to Coach Busalaki, like always, before the game, and we talked about this Cornell team. She had some interesting comments. In the top here in conference, 9-0, pristine record. Now he just walked by Coach Brassey. When you came in, I was thinking about this today, when you came into the conference, when you were hired 11 seasons ago, as that Eagles song goes, there's a new kid in town, and that was you. And he was the guy that was kind of like, you look at, hey, this is the mountain I got to climb. This is the guy, he had the Diamond Boyds of the world, and that was the team you had to go after. And now he's chasing you. So what do you think about today's matchup?
Yeah, Coach has done an awesome job with his program right from start to now as well. They're going to be physical. They'll be the most physical team that we've faced in league so far up to this point. They can shoot the three at a high rate as well, so we've got to make sure that we defend and we're contesting, trying to not give up easy shots. And then hopefully on the offensive end, they play with a ton of pressure historically, so we've got to take care of the ball, you know, hit each other in our hands and try to get really good looks.
You know, 10 days ago, they were two games ahead of the next nearest competitor, all in sole place of second place, all by themselves. Then they lose a 4-point game. Then they lose in overtime, and now they come in here. So this is a wounded animal, Coach.
Yeah, they're going to be tough. They're a super aggressive team. He's done a great job just getting them prepared every single day and getting better all year. So we've got a battle ahead of us, and that's what it's all about this last month.
Is there anything that we look for today from your players that'll be a key to success in today's game?
Yeah, hopefully taking care of the ball, rebounding. You know, we've got to take care of those two categories, and you know, we're home and You can't be successful in basketball if you're not making shots. So hopefully you see some of that today as well.
Okay. Hey, I want to thank you once again for your time and good luck today.
Thanks, Marty. Thanks for being here. Thanks,
you're welcome.
Some great stuff from Coach Busalaki, and we're really looking forward to seeing how this game plays out after what she talked about.
I'll tell you. We go, there's no anthem, of course. We do the double headers because that was in the early on. So we'll have player introductions here. But if there's a team that, if you're a Redhawk fan, that makes me nervous, it's this coach and his squad.
Yes, and going into those starting lineups, first for the visiting Cornell College Lady Rams, at guard, number 12, Callie March, the 5'5" senior from Littleton, Colorado. Number 15, Aaron Jackson, also at guard, the 5'6" sophomore from Woodstock, Georgia. Number 25, Rachel Adewusi, the 5'10" senior from Warren, Michigan. Number 34, Anijah Simmons, the 5'10" senior from Chicago, Illinois. And number 50, Mia Murray, the 5'5" junior from Middleton, Wisconsin. So not a lot of height on this squad.
No, but you're going to see a lot of quickness from number 12 and number 15, their guard play. And like you said, not a lot of height, but you can certainly see size as something that the physicality of the post play, I think, will be pretty obvious.
And for the home Ripon College women, starting at guard, number 0, Bella Opelt, the 5'3" junior from Neillsville, Wisconsin. Number 3, Lainey Havlovitz, the 5'3" freshman from Wild Rose, Wisconsin. Number 11, Natalie Rowell, the 5'8" sophomore from Madison. Number 14, Bonnie Jensen, the 5'11" senior from Muskego, Wisconsin. And number 30, Ella Tempest, the leading scorer for this Ripon College women's team, the 5'11" junior from Oostburg, Wisconsin, and a transfer from Wisconsin Lutheran College.
Yeah. So there, you notice the uniforms by Ripon today. Those are a salute to the late Julie Johnson.
Ah.
And they wear those every so many home games each season. They've done that for the last few years since Julie's passing. So that's why they're wearing not their non-traditional white, red, and black uniforms. I think the challenge for Ripon today, as Coach Buzalaki put it, cut right to the chase. It's the pressure applied by the Rams defensively. And then conversely, Ripon's challenge will be, can they take away or at least minimize the dribble penetration by that backcourt for the Rams, led by the senior Callie Marsh, and then Jackson, the sophomore guard out of Woodstock, Georgia. So, so that's what's going to be going on here. Can Ripon stay undefeated is the big question. And can Coach Brassey, a very successful program that he's had, can they come out of that two-game losing streak and upset the home favored Redhawks? You know, you look at Coach Brassey and what he's been able to accomplish, it's pretty impressive. 18 seasons, 4 Midwest Conference championships, 2 NCAA Division III tournament berths. He has appeared in 5 of the past 10 Midwest Conference tournament championship games. Think about that. And then he's also qualified for the conference tournament itself 9 times since 2012. So he's got a resume. And one of the best players I ever saw in Midwest Conference was Diamond Boyd. And she was quite the player. But so Ripon's got their hands full, but this is good. This is why they play that tough non-conference schedule, Crete, for sure. And, you know, we talk about Coach Brassey. Hey, what about Coach Buzalaki? She's gone 59-17 at home over the past 7 seniors. That is a nuts winning percentage.
Yes, it is.
Also, she's appeared in the 4-team Midwest postseason conference tournament in each of the last 7 straight seasons. And then she's hosted the last 5 of those.
That is an insane resume from Coach Buzalaki.
Oh, and did I mention he's given in his birth 2 children?
Ah.
That's something
the
that
most important of all those numbers.
Yeah, absolutely. So, we got a game. It's alumni weekend also. It's nice to see some of the familiar faces back here on campus.
As a freshman, I'm not sure what those faces are, but I'm sure it's nice to see them.
And I had I known, I would have tried to get here early to watch the alumni games, because those are fun.
Well, Ripon in the green and red uniforms, Cornell in the white with purple trim, and the opening tip is controlled by Cornell. Callie March over to Aaron Jackson, who's working on it. Back to Callie March, gives it in to number 25, Rachel Adewusi. Spin around, turn, rolls it in off the front of the iron.
Quick pivot move, nice feet. Watch the matchup. Opelt also guarding Marsh for them. And she's, look how she'll be on Havlovitz.
Havlovitz working up on top, looking to get an open woman. working as Opelt. Bonnie Jensen gets it down low to Tempest. Stolen right away from number 25 out of Lucy.
She put it on the floor instead of just pivot and triple threat square up.
Tempest, as we said earlier, the leading scorer on this Ripon women's college team. 13.7 per game, also averaging 8 rebounds.
Nice shot by Jensen, taking away the three-point shot.
Chucks one up, no good off the glass. Pavlovich running the floor, looking for an open option. Gets a screen from Tempest. Gets it to her at the free throw line, throw down to Jensen. Jensen's gonna turn around, go up, and put it in.
Tough ball shot. Game. Her body was behind the backboard on that.
And Bonnie Jensen is one of those players, she knows how to work her body down low. She knows how to move her body into position.
I call her roadblock. I mean, she's something on both ends. Very physical type of player, which will lend itself well to this matchup today. Got a switch here. Tempest on the quick march.
Turnaround fadeaway will roll out. Opelt bringing it up again. Works it over to Havlovich. Caught about a three, didn't take it.
Nice cut.
Cut by Rawolf. Got it down low, but too low. Gives it to Tempest, who now hits. That's going to be a foul on Havlovich. Havlovich is going to go to the line and shoot two.
The thing with Havlovich that I've started understanding, she's the point guard, right?
Yeah.
But she moves so well without the ball.
Yes, she does.
She makes herself available and is going to shoot two because of it right now.
And during this break, I also want to give a minute to shout out everyone who's been listening to us, whether it be in Wisconsin or over the border in Illinois.
Yeah.
It's a full day of basketball, and we are glad that you are here joining with us.
Or Iowa. In Mount Vernon, Iowa, off of Route 1. Solid free throws.
That's on me. I thought Cornell was in Illinois.
Hey, it starts with an I.
Yeah, that's close.
Here we go. They're running, just kind of handing it off, back to forth on top.
Callie March with the ball now. Kicked away by Tempest. Can't do that in basketball, but it still works.
Yeah, if it hits a stationary foot, it may not
it's
be
fine.
A whistle. Yeah,
oh.
Yeah.
It's a down low to number 44, Brady Buffington.
Look at Jensen, the big
Jensen
dribbling.
Jensen running the floor. Throws it up with the right hand. No good. Tempest almost grabbed the offensive rebound. It's going to be off Tempest. It's going to be Cornell ball.
What a battle. Jensen and Tempest going
Brent
at
Brent Brassey, very animated on the sidelines after that.
He realizes, for him, this is a must-win today.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Callie March working it around the perimeter. Gives it over to number 22, Heidi Jorgensen, out of Manthee, Utah. Back to March. March looking, searching. Gives it to Aaron Jackson.
Oh, got
gets
a mismatch.
It into Buffington.
Yeah, I have a mismatch with Opelt.
Number 22, that was Jorgensen with the three-pointer that rimmed out.
I think Cornell missed an opportunity to feed the big because they had Opelt on her.
Rawolf into Jensen. Oh, had Tempest open.
Oh, yeah, she did.
Gets it back into Jensen. No, nice dump down low to Tempest, and she puts it in for two.
That was nice. We saw the Cornell men do that today.
Yeah, they were running it to perfection. They just didn't run it enough, honestly. It's one of the most difficult plays in basketball to defend when it's done right.
Yeah, when you're overplaying defensively like Ripon was, the back door on the baseline is there. Here we go. Look at that tight defense.
March with the ball, guarded now by Jensen.
Oh,
knocked away. Aaron Jackson from three, no good. Rebound to Havlovich.
Ripon doing a good job of one and done
Havlovich
so far.
Running the floor, gets it to Jensen, who goes up with the left hand and puts it in off the glass.
Coach Brassey has to take a 30-second timeout. You know, that's the thing. If you're pressuring like that, man, you got to get back.
And you that's really do.
And that's what he's going to remind him of. So Ripon's in first place at 9-0. Cornell, I talked about them, where they're now 6-3. And 10 days ago, they were 6-1 and looking really good. And now they got Knox, or I should say they got Grinnell and Lawrence at 6-4, right on their heels, tied for the third spot. And then you got Knox at 5-4, and then you have Beloit and Illinois College at 5-5. You got two games in the loss column with six teams vying for the last two slots in the postseason tournament. It's much tighter than the men's situation.
And what people are wondering is, what will the history books say when this whole season is over?
Yeah, I don't know about that, but right now it's going to be a food fight.
It is.
And the game also to keep your eyes on today, I think it's Knox at Grinnell.
Oh, crossed up number 20, Abby Hartman, but passed it out to the corner. Now March again, guarded by Hartman, gets it down low.
Nice defense.
Adewusi throws one off the backboard. No good, but the rebound goes to number 23, Riley Van Dresser.
Yeah, the help defense by Jensen was great. He just didn't get the rebound.
Now throws one up, and that's going to be a foul.
Yeah, they're going to call the hip check, the trip, if you will.
Believe it's going to be on Abby Hartman. Yes, it is. Out of Wonder Lake, Illinois, Woodstock North.
Yeah. I always joke about that. She can actually say, yeah, I've been to Woodstock. I was at Woodstock. The one thing with these uniforms, it's the numbers don't stand out quite as clearly.
Yeah.
It's got a little bit of a double look. Marcia, seasoned pro. In fact, she's the most seasoned player for Coach Brassey for the Cornell Rams. They have... almost looks like a zone sometimes, but it's not. They're staying in their man.
As you were saying earlier, March, one of only two seniors on this roster.
I didn't even know that.
Havlovitz with the ball. Oh, thought about Rawls. Now she gets it to her. Now she gets
what
it to Jensen. Jensen goes up and is fouled. He'll go to the line to shoot two.
The one thing that we've seen right away here in the first less than 5 minutes of action, Ripon feeding the post. And to do that, they got players one after another going down the lane line, making themselves available, feeding the post, and getting early fouls on Cornell.
Jensen sinks her first free throw.
Hartman off the bench, coming off of that timeout called by Brassey. Both and solid, by Jensen. The fifth-year senior taking advantage of the COVID situation.
Jensen now over to Rowell, who's on March, now switches to Jensen. Number 10, Tenley Cavanaugh with the ball, passes it over to number shot. It's good, nylon from Callie March.
Yeah, and that was a deep three, by the way.
Yes, it was. Over to Hartman. Looking for Tempest up at the elbow. Pass down low to Rawolf. Knocked away by March, out of bounds. Ripon will retain possession.
Yeah, and she did a nice job, but she ran out of real estate, Rawolf, and she was to avoid falling out of bounds and turning the ball over. Fortunate to get the ball to go off the visitors, so 14 on that shot clock.
Checking back into the game is Bella Opelt for Ripon, number zero. Looking for an open lady. It's going to go... Oh, from this angle, it looks like it went off the knee of number 23,
what happened was it slipped off the hands of the Ripon player, but then went off the shins of the defender. Didn't get caught, and so it's turnover on Ripon. This is going to be an aggressive game throughout, I anticipate.
Thought about a shot twice there for a second and then passed it off. Number 23, Van Dresser. Aaron Jackson from three. Short. Grabbed by Tempest.
The other thing for Ripon to have success today, not only just taking care of the ball in general.
Rawl from three. Nylon! Natalie Rawl!
Not only that, she leads the team in shooting percentage on the three ball, just under 40%. So,
from beyond the perimeter, Natalie Rawl is the most dangerous option on this Ripon team. Adewusi thought about a shot. Now she's going to drive. Up with the right hand. No good. Grabbed by Tempest again. Another rebound from Ella Tempest. She is close to averaging a double-double in the season. It's almost her specialty move. Now Opelt from three. Rims out. Rawl grabs it. Gives it back to Opelt. Over to Hartman. Look for Jensen. Rawl down low.
Lots of time.
10 on the shot clock. Hartman, long two, airballs it.
Yeah, she aimed it instead of shooting it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. You're an athlete. You know, sometimes you try to guide something or aim it instead of just go with it. That's what that was.
Number 10, Anna Fahmy.
Barney.
Barney.
Barney, yep.
And
so what else we got out here?
And Havlovitz also checked in.
Yeah, and then the big, she's got her hair covering up the number.
34.
Yeah, Cunningham.
Anna Cunningham.
Anna, yeah. Met her over at the house when we were feeding players over the Christmas break. Tough shot. Cunningham with that rebound gets it to the
Havlovitz
freshman guard.
Bringing it up. Havlovitz might think about a three. Nope. He gives it to Opel. Opel drives. Havlovitz taking it with the left hand. Back to Opel. Working it. Cunningham might want to go to work here with the right hand.
Yeah, 3 seconds.
3 seconds in the lane.
Oh, yeah. You got to know where you're at. And you know Brassy's going to be letting that ref know, and I would too.
Number 44, Brady Buffington, getting checked in for Cornell again.
2.5 minutes exactly remaining in the first quarter of action here on the Ripon campus in the Wilmore Center. Ripon up 12-7. More changes here. Heidi Jorgensen in for
Aaron Jackson.
Yep, in the Rams. Ripon up by 5. Freshman here out of Arizona with the ball.
Number 5, Kylie Edris.
Tough shot.
Scissor kick shot from Anijah Simmons.
Yeah, she shoots jumpers, and from the looks of things, she's probably had some work done on that left knee.
Yeah. Cunningham with it. Goes to work. Left hand. Kisses it in.
Beautiful. That was gorgeous.
Yes, it was. A great spin move from Anna Cunningham.
Wausau West.
Gets it into Buffington. She might go to work now. Nope, goes back to Anijah.
From the elbow, missed everything.
Throws it right off the backboard. Check that thing for cracks.
Cunningham with a great job denying that putback.
Jensen gives it over to Farney. And a foul is going to be called on number 50.
They're going to call the hold.
It's going to be Raul Tempest and number 23, Bree Miller, checked in for the Redhawks. Bree Miller out of Fond du Lac, Wisconsin.
Yeah, transfer out of, she came out of Dubuque University, I think.
Tempest with it. She's going to go to work with the left hand. No good. Almost grabbed her own
rebound.
Yes,
she did. There's a freshman with the ball. Looked like a carry. She's quick.
Yep.
He's got both point guards playing now, Brassy. A little out of control on the shot.
Anijah Simmons out of control most times. Havlovitz throws one up with the right hand and one. Lady Havlovitz, the freshman.
Coach Brassy does not like the call. He's doing what he can to protect his players. I got news for you. That was a heck of a move in any kind of body. And you know, when you're going to protect the shooter every time you go up.
And Brassy is losing it right now on the left.
And I've seen other coaches, men and women, that come into this gym and do that. I don't see the Ripon coaches do that with officials. They don't really work them, I don't think.
No.
Missed that free throw.
Mia Murray running the floor. Throws a quick pass over to Callie March. But she is stopped by Natalie Rowell. Now Tempest on Murray. Throws one up with the right hand. That was just a wild, uncontrolled shot.
The dribble drives are impressive, especially with a fake crossover.
Let's go in again. Gets stuck. And it's going to go out of bounds off her. The shot blocked, hit her hand, and fell out of bounds.
Yeah. Hey, don't kid yourself. Let's just keep this in our back pocket. Working that official on that call to see if that comes into play later in the game. You know, on a tight call, we'll see how that works. Here we go. 16-9, half a minute left in the first quarter. Ripping up. About 2 seconds differential, shot clock, game clock.
Number 25, Adewusi with the ball. Gives it to March. March.
Oh,
right back to Adewusi. Bree Miller can't
what
come over
pass.
And play.
What a pass by March.
Great pass. 4 seconds left. 3 seconds left. 2 seconds left. Miller, they just didn't know what got it off. They didn't know how much time was left.
No. And it's important. If you don't, teammates, always remind your teammates how much time is left on the clock at any given time. Well, we got one quarter of play under our belts.
16-11 Redhawks. Good game so far.
Yeah, I think Ripon's plan, I talked about it earlier, it's become pretty apparent. Yeah, if you're open, you'll take the jumper, but they're really trying to attack the lane and get to the rim with higher percentage shots. Cornell, I think they're just trying to defensively pressure Ripon, but Ripon's doing a good job of attacking the rim. I think offensively, Cornell will take what you give them. I mean, you know, if you're open on a three, I'm going to take it. If I'm open on a two, I'll take it. The bigs, you mentioned, they're not for tallness, they're not, but for thickness and ball skill with the bigs and handling the ball, pretty impressive. But like we've noticed, they're kind of at times out of control when attacking the rim with the shot. With Cornell. And I was not cognizant that there's only two seniors on that squad with Coach Brassi.
Yeah, they are a young core that should be around to play good basketball for a while here at Cornell.
Yeah, but and that was interesting where he had number five, the freshman point guard, the young lady from Vail, Arizona, not Colorado, that she was out there with Marsh, the senior. I think he was going for a little more quickness, overall quickness, see if he can do some more dribble drive against the defense. I think the man-to-man by Ripon in general in that first quarter was sound.
Very solid.
And nobody in foul trouble either. That's important that both bigs, Jensen and Tempest, stay out of early foul trouble.
Indeed.
We haven't seen, other than the one open three by Raw Wolf, we haven't seen Raw Wolf get a shot much.
Yeah. Ripon with the ball to start the second quarter. Now Raul with it. Gets it to Opel. Gets it to Tempest. Yeah. Tempest looking around. Almost had Jensen open. Now Tempest might have to go to work.
That's what I like seeing.
And throws one at the Cornell bench.
Yeah. What I like seeing was she's playing the high post, Tempest. She caught and then she squared up.
Yeah.
And that's what you want to do. You don't want to put it on the floor with your back to the defender. That spells trouble.
One of the reactions from one of the Cornell players on the bench, I think it was Buffington, was scary.
Yeah, I saw that. Ooh. High post, in out.
Callie March from three. Nylon.
Isn't she a player?
She is a player.
Smooth.
14-16 now. Cornell trailing Ripon. Pavlovich carrying it up the floor. Gives it to Opelt. Works it into Jensen.
Yeah, one possession game now.
Now Tempest, she's looking to get it back to Jensen. It's knocked away. Tempest right back with it. Might have to get it out of the post for a second. Opelt is going to take one from him. That's not a good shot.
Nope. It was a tough one. And then
and
a silly foul.
Foul is going to go the other way.
That's just not a good foul by Jensen. Not a good foul. You know, you can, like you said, go ahead and post. And then repost, they'll get the ball back. Ripon will feed you if they can.
100%.
But all of a sudden, the ability to attack the rim in the first quarter, Coach Brassi's made that adjustment already where he's not letting that ball get down low, at least not yet.
Callie March dribbling around. Three again. No good. Grab by Tempest. Oh!
Yeah.
Bonnie Jensen took a shot. Ella Tempest.
I call her roadblock.
Well, the roadblock fell on that one.
Yeah.
Raul Wolf thought about the three, didn't take it.
Crossover.
Gets it to Tempest. Oh, fake. Two of them out of their shoes. Ella Tempest was one of the better shot fakes you will see down low.
Everybody wants to block shots. And if you use that to your advantage, we just saw what can happen. Smart play by Tempest.
Brassi might be out of breath on the sideline. He is losing it right now.
Ripon by just 4 points.
7:45 left to go in this first half. 8 seconds left on the shot clock. Now to the corner. Rims out. Rebound grab. Tie up. The ball's going to go to the Redhawks.
That was a great job by Cornell.
Nope, it's going to stay. It's going to stay with Cornell.
I don't understand that because they have the possession arrow is with Ripon. So the possession arrow is incorrect, evidently.
Come on, scoreboard guys. Let's get it together.
Here we go.
I'm kidding. You're doing a great job.
Yeah, we're a small town.
Yeah. Knocked away a little bit. Rawolf. Rawolf and Havovitz with a great double team there for a second. Now back to Callie March. 8 seconds left on the clock. Knocked away by Rawolf. That's going to be out of bounds on Cornell. Ripon's going to get the ball.
She didn't get the memo. The ball was off of Rawolf. You don't try to save a ball off the other team. Ripon got a break. See if they capitalize to improve on the four-point lead.
Always capitalize. Can't not. Gets it in low to Jensen. Tempest, what a pass. Tempest puts it in.
Are the bigs putting on a nice display of two-man ball right now?
Big facilitators are hard to come by, but when they do, they are beautiful things to watch. Knocked away by Havovitz. Now Callie March gets it over to number 10, Tenley Cavanaugh. Now Adewusi going to work. Spin move.
Lost her dribble. All of a sudden, you got 3 seconds on the shot clock.
Launches one up, March, no good. Tempest with another rebound.
Don't bring it down to your waist.
Tempest is 6 points. It's got to be double-digit rebounds at this point. Rawolf gets, whoa.
That's an easy call.
She let go of the ball there for a second and almost took off the head of the photographer you see down there on the brown sweatshirt.
Coach Brassi not taking issue with that call.
No.
Hey, Marsh is out of the game. Takes the blow. And in fact, he's got reinforcements. He sent in the freshman point guard along with, I think, number 12. No, that's Marsh. Oh, I'm sorry. Marsh is still out there. I saw another 22 take coming off the court.
Rawolf makes both free throws to make it an 8-point lead for the Redhawks with 6.5 left in this first half.
So Marsh doesn't get a cup of coffee. She doesn't get a break.
Nope. And that's what you ask of your star players. You ask for them to play the majority of the game with minimal breaks, if any. Number 5, Kylie Idris moves it over to Cavanaugh. Now to Buffington. Buffington just launched one into the Ripon bench. Wow.
Yeah, sometimes you have the big hitting the guard, and that's what happens on the long pass.
That's what we call a SAP, a super airmail pass.
Yeah, out of Winfield, Iowa, the freshman. Buffington.
Jensen at the elbow. Drives in. Spin move. Gives it to Tempest. Tempest fouled on the shot. Great passing by Bonnie Jensen and Ella Tempest. They are just on the same wavelength. They are finding each other.
They're playing a two-man game.
They're doing it well.
Now we got Vanessa for Ripon. Vanessa Solano is in. She cut her teeth coming in here. She's got the school record in high school of three-point shooting. So we know what she can do offensively. And, in fact, I saw, I think it was the last game, maybe she was 2 for 2 on threes. Solid by Tempest at the free throw line. Ripon with a first double-digit lead of the game. But I can't get over the way both Ripon bigs are playing right now, Jensen and Tempest.
Sometimes there are two people who are meant to be in the same place as each other. This is right now with Tempest and Jensen.
And today's game in the first half, absolutely.
3 seconds left on the shot clock. Turnaround from Simmons, no good. Rebound goes to Havovitz. Mm-hmm. Tempest wants it. Wants it, doesn't get it. Rawolf thought about the three, now waiting for it, gives it to Jensen. Pass to Tempest. What are we saying here?
It's ball watching, not and losing track of your man, and that's what's killing them right now. You got to have your feeler on your man and your eye on the ball.
It's simple.
And when you take And when you take a little, just a slight break away from your person, and Brassy's screaming it right now in that huddle. Look at him. He says, I cannot believe you're losing the location of your opponent.
And it's not even a trick play. The minute Jensen gets the ball down on the blocks, her eyes turn and find Tempest, and she is just ripping passes right to her.
Right. And what players like Rawlwolf and the guard play by Ripon, what they're doing when they have the ball out on top or on the wing, they're just showing triple threat. You have to be respected as a shooter. So if your intent is to pass, the defender has to get close on you, and then it makes your passing a lot easier to your teammate.
Exactly.
So nice job by Ripon. And I can't remember the last time I saw Cornell have to take three timeouts because things aren't going well.
In the first half, nonetheless.
Yeah.
And this is what you were talking about earlier. Cornell has lost their footing in this Midwest Conference and as a team as of late.
Oh, tipped away, but they found
it. Adewusi throws one up off the front of the iron, rebound to Tempest. She's got to be at a double-double already in the first half.
Pretty much the whole offense has been perimeter by Cornell, just with the exception of a few baskets.
Gets it to Jensen, and her eyes. It doesn't matter where she is. The eyes go to Tempest, and that's going to be a travel. She caught it between her legs and shuffle step.
Yeah, the bounce pass was a little too low.
Yep.
You got to hit him in the hands at the waist on the target. Appreciate what was being attempted.
Tempest being checked out now for Anna Cunningham.
I like that. With Jensen's double team recognized it, and her teammate did. Tempest going right down Main Street. They're just playing really high IQ basketball
yes,
here.
Yes, they are. Gets it to March.
That's a walk.
That was a walk. Murray with the ball up on top. Gives it to Adewusi. 7 seconds left. March throws up a floater, and that goes in.
Yeah, she's the one that got away with the walk, but it happens to all of them. Ripon looking good, though, still maintaining a 10-point lead.
Bringing it up. Vanessa Solano gets it down low to Jensen. Jensen working. Jensen left-handed scoop, up and in.
Wow.
Oh, my.
And the chest of the defender was right in her face.
Murray over to the corner. Number 22, Jorgensen, no good. Rebound to Havlovitz.
Cunningham.
Havlovitz running the floor.
Yeah.
Goes up. Lost it. It's going to be out of bounds off her. It's going to be Cornell basketball.
Cunningham also out there for Ripon, I should say. When Solano came in, Cunningham must have as well, and I missed that.
Yeah, she was checked in for Tempest.
So Opelt now comes in. She'll stir the drink now for Ripon while Havlovitz takes a break. Under 3.5 remaining in the first half.
Jorgensen working
12.
It over to Aaron Jackson. Brent Brassy, nothing's going his way, and you can see it in his eyes. He is annoyed by it.
He's a competitor.
He is. And that's what you love to see. You love to see two competitive teams. As number 25, Rachel Adewusi, gets fouled and will go to the line to shoot two.
They're going to call it on Cunningham for Ripon.
So far, with just over 3 minutes left in this first half, Cornell has yet to hit the 20-point mark. A great defensive effort by Ripon so far.
Why do they have 12 for Ripon on the foul? She's not out there. It was on Cunningham, not Solano. All right. Well, they got the foul.
She missed both free throws. Rawlwolf looking, trying to find an open teammate.
Double.
Knocked out of bounds by Cornell by Callie March.
Yeah, you catch that ball to a teammate down on the baseline, you definitely want to keep your dribble alive.
Yeah.
Rawlwolf so far in the first half playing the role of as a facilitator more than a scorer. So they did call that foul on Solano.
4 seconds left on the clock. Three.
Off the foot. I'd like to have seen Hartman just shoot that baseline jumper.
No, Hartman on March. Adewusi gets it taken away from her.
Hartman
on the run. Hartman gives it to Solano. Solano's got Opelt. Opelt thought about it. She was open.
Yeah, she could have taken it, and she decided not to.
Cunningham. Oh, Cunningham had Artman on the back door.
And she had the ball at her waist.
Can't do it.
Marsh. There's the Marsh with the ball. Good denial. Hartman denying on the block. They're going to have to rush a shot here. How is Marsh going to get that even off?
Wow, she almost hit it. Oh, and the rebound goes right back to number 23, Rand Dresser, but she missed the putback. It's going to be a timeout.
When it gets subs in.
It's going to be Tempest, Jensen, and Havelvitz are going to be checked in for the Redhawks.
Wow. It's 28-16, Ripon. So around the conference today, 5-4 Knox is at Monmouth. And Monmouth is new coach, hasn't even been there, what, nine months? So they're struggling. So figure Knox is, you know, they're in a third position. No, Knox is in fifth position. So they should come out on top. But Grinnell at Illinois College today. Grinnell is tied for third with a 6-4 record. And they are at Illinois College, who's 5-5. But believe me, Illinois College is very capable. That's the game to watch. Lawrence should have no problem at Lake Forest today. They're 6-4. They're tied with Grinnell for the third spot. It's all bunching up.
Tempest hands it off to Havelitz, who now looks for the open teammate. Gets it to Tempest, who looked to Jensen.
3 seconds
on
Jensen.
In the line.
Yeah.
In the
play was there. I liked it.
Tempest and Jensen, I'm telling you, it's an elite combo here in this conference.
They're back to doing what they were doing before, and they're getting the ball more successfully into the block.
Definitely. Shot from Aaron Jackson, rims out. That was in and out of the rim. Minute left in the first half as Havelvitz working up on top, looking for Tempest. Now Jensen gives it to Tempest. Tempest goes up, no good. Doesn't grab the rebound, that's Buffington with the rebound. Gives it to Callie March, 45 seconds left. Tempest guarding Aaron Jackson up on the top. Hartman nearly stripped that pass away from March. Buffington guarded by Tempest.
Yeah, Hartman got to get out on her.
There's a shot from March. It's good. Nylon.
Hartman took her eye off of Marsh, and it cost Ripon. You got to stay on Marsh. She is the best scorer. She's the scorer.
I'd imagine Ripon's going to hold this one to get the last shot of the half. Gives it to Tempest. 10 seconds left on the clock. Gives it to Opelt. Opelt over to Havelvitz. 5 seconds left. 4, 3. Tempest goes up. No good. Grabs her own rebound. Goes up. Fouled before the buzzer. Tempest is going to get 2 shots.
Wow.
Great resolve by Tempest to grab her own board and put up another shot and get fouled before time ran out. So now she has the opportunity to make, you don't see this every day, buzzer beater free throws.
Yeah, and it's definitely a different feeling when you're standing there all by yourself at a naked free throw line.
She hits the first one. Well, Tempest with a unique form. A unique form. She doesn't dribble. She doesn't spin the ball much.
Holds it and just shoots it, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. That is.
And she hits them both. So Ella Tempest to beat the buzzer. 2 free throws at the end of the first half. Ripon leads 30-19 over the Cornell Lady Rams.
Yeah, yeah. You know, if you're Ripon, you're feeling really good about yourself right now, the way you've been able to play this first 20 minutes of action.
Well, at the end of one, the Redhawks lead 30-19 over the Cornell Lady Rams. We'll be back in a while with
those stats. Yeah.
With stats, and we'll give you the second half of action here. This is Ripon College Basketball on the Ripon Channel.
Thank you.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome back to Ripon College Basketball on the Ripon Channel. If you're just joining us, you've missed a good first half of basketball. The Lady Redhawks lead the Lady Rams of Cornell 30-19. And we have some stats here that we'd like to share with you from the first half. First, for the visiting Cornell College Lady Rams, their philosophy is to pressure you offensively. But it only really works if you can make the shots that you pressure them with. 30 shots they've thrown up in the first half, they only made 7 of them. And 3 of 13 from 3-point range is the more alarming number. As for Ripon on that side, 10 of 18 from field goals for a 56% clip. And they've only taken 2 3-pointers, but they are 1 of 2 from there, so 50% of that. But I guess the real story here is Ella Tempest, who already has a double-double going into the second half of this ballgame. Martin, she's really played a complete game so far.
She's doing a couple of things very well. We talked about her connection with Jensen, those two bigs playing off of one another. The other thing, she's finishing around the rim and she's moving without the ball. She's slicing through the lane, coming oftentimes from the weak side, from non-ball side, and they're doing a great job, whether it be the guards feeding from out on the wing or whether it's someone like a Jensen on the little drop-off pass in the lane. It's worked to perfection for Coach Buzalaki's ladies, and the recipient so far in this game has been Tempest, as you mentioned. And they've done just a great job of attacking the rim. A lot of baseline cuts, too, backdoor cuts. It's been really ripping. It seems like they've been one step ahead of the defense in those in that first half. So we'll have to see what happens in the second. We kind of had the same kind of thoughts. And then the rebounding differential, too, between the two ball clubs is considerable, where you have 9 boards for Cornell and Ripon doubling them up with 21 boards. And you talked early on in the men's game that Ripon won today over the Cornell men, their counterpart, about, hey, you control the boards, and statistically, you're normally going to walk out with that W.
Yeah, and also, the other thing that Cornell should be worried about is their lack of a balanced scoring attack. Callie March with 13 points. They have 19 points total. They might want to think about spreading it around so Ripon has to actually think about who they need to guard and stop from scoring.
And they have. And the two bigs in particular have attacked with dribble drive. That's the thing. Instead of making themselves available for an entry pass, they're trying to put the whole offense on their shoulders, in my opinion, attack with the dribble. And oftentimes the help defense that's been so good for Ripon makes them take a forced shot. And that's why their shooting percentage just isn't, it's not a good one for the Rams. Yeah, we're a little less than a minute from the start of the second half. So if you're not familiar, these uniforms, they break them out. They first brought those out a few years ago as a salute. And I believe Julie Johnson, the big C, cancer took her life. And I know that those uniforms have a lot to do with that, doing that to the late, great Julie Johnson, who has the basketball court here in the Weiske Memorial Gymnasium. She's shares the naming of the court, if you would, with Bob Gillespie, the late Julie Johnson. So, yeah, they were talking about, I believe, over 300 wins.
Fourth most in Midwest Conference history, if I heard correctly.
Awesome.
And Brent Brassey, the longtime head coach for Cornell, was very animated with his players on the sideline during timeouts and during the game of the first half. He is not accustomed to seeing his team play like this.
Yeah. Well, he's definitely a motivator. He's definitely a leader. And he's got a resume that shows that he's a winner, both on men's and women's collegiate basketball.
Ripon starting with the ball in the second half. Havlovitz moves it over to Opelt, now working around, gets it to Tempest. Kind of got a hand locked in there by Mia Murray.
Yeah, it's really physical.
Yeah, it is.
They're trying to intimidate
it
a little bit.
Gets it to Jensen. Jensen goes up with the right hand, kisses it in off the glass. Yeah. Just a nice little.
They're getting bodied. Arms, if you watch, arms are straight up, but they're hipping the Ripon players. We'll see if that continues to be allowed.
Adewusi from an elbow jumper. No good. Grabbed by Tempest. Going to be a loose ball foul by number 34. Anaya Simmons.
I remember her from previous seasons.
Havlovitz bringing it up now.
I'll guarantee you, the word from Brassey was in the locker room was, you're going to D up a lot more aggressive this second half. We need to climb back into this game.
And you can see that they double-teamed Jensen to take away the ability to pass. Havlovitz from three, no good. They're going to D up on Havlovitz a lot. Or no, not Havlovitz. Jensen, because it was her ability to pass that brought on the double-team.
Here we go.
You double team it makes it harder for someone to get a pass off.
Freshman versus senior, Havlovitz on Marsh.
Anaya Simmons loses it. It's going to go out of bounds. And Brent Brassey wants another foul.
Well, and it was. Tempest got away. What I was talking about down at the other end, where Ripon was being bodied, Tempest just did it to the Cornell player, and he's letting him. The ref, no. Interestingly enough, he didn't complain when the Ripon players were getting bodied. I'm being facetious, of course.
I would not be surprised if he is very close to being on the edge of this ref's last nerve. Been yelling at him all game. There's a difference between yelling and sort of warming up with calls and just words.
Had to hoist it.
Yep.
And did hit iron, but shot clock. Good defense by Ripon again.
Havlovitz gets it to Tempest. Tempest has a mismatch with March guarding her. She's going to act on it. Gives it to Havlovitz in the corner. Havlovitz thought about it. Now trying to get it in. Gets it to Jensen. Gets it to Tempest. Tempest is going to go up with the left hand and put it in.
It is such a nice job to have Tempest on the block. Jensen is weak side, but then she shoots up to the high post, receives the ball, and then right down the lane line to Tempest to go one-on-one.
And
that's beautiful coaching by Buzalaki.
Exactly. And props to Ripon. Cornell is trying to place their defense, so they're not allowed to. Ripon is not going away from what worked in the first half.
Look at
Havlovitz to the corner. Opelt driving.
Yeah. Inside out. Great ball reversal by Ripon again.
Great pass to Jensen down low. Jensen, foul. I believe she's going to go to the line to shoot two. Nope, it's going to be on the ground.
Yeah, and it was. It's the right call.
15-point lead now for Ripon with 7:30 left in this first half or in this third quarter.
But like I said, players like Opelt. Oh, look at that inbounds.
Look at that. Natalie Rawolf with the 2-point layup.
Rawolf and Opelt have been facilitators today. They're not hunting their shots, really. They're just doing a great job. They're buying into what Buzalaki is selling today, and it's attacking the rim with the bigs.
You love to see it. Airmail.
There's some frustration right there.
Whoops, there it went.
Didn't see it called, but we got a timeout. You got to believe it was by Cornell College, 36-19. And it's a very frustrated Cornell team on the verge
of collapsing.
Of three straight losses. They, to no surprise, they play the same type of non-conference schedule that Buzalaki does. Brassia, when you look at, go online and you're looking at their schedule for the season, they do a tough schedule, let me tell you. They're playing the good Iowa schools and some of the Wisconsin State schools.
And that's what you got to be if you want to be the best. You got to play the best.
Yeah, I mean, right. You can pad your schedule and feel good about your win-loss column, but then when you get into the dogfight,
might not always be the best option.
Yeah, here you go.
Great pass down low to Tempest. Jensen gets fouled. That's going to be a shooting foul. Jensen's going to go to the line and shoot two with a chance to make it 38-19 and double the Ripon lead on the Rams.
I think Cornell's frustration is going back to that first half. when the bigs were attacking the rim, they could not get anything to fall.
No, they could not.
And I think that the only thing that even was doing anything was Marsh from downtown.
Yep.
And that's been their problem, scoring in the post.
Marsh in the first half was 3 of 6 from field, from three-point land.
Yeah, and nothing to speak of in terms of production from the post for Cornell in the first half.
Jorgensen tried to go baseline, was stopped by Rawolf. Now gets it to Van Dresser. Back to Van Dresser. Tried
defense.
To go for the reverse. No good. Rebound grabbed by Jensen.
Well, what does that tell you? You got the two bigs fighting for the rebound.
Yep.
For
Pavlovitz.
Ripon. Yeah.
Pavlovitz looked for 10 pass, couldn't get it to her. Rawolf thinks about it. Natalie Rawolf, she can shoot the three. She's the most dangerous weapon to shoot the three. Oh, she had him on a back cut right there. Didn't see her. Tempest gets her pass knocked away.
Yeah.
10 seconds left. 8 seconds left on the shot clock. Pavlovitz is going to try and throw one up. No.
That'll be a turnover on Ripon with 1 second left on the shot clock. The other thing that I'm seeing here, Ripon, their spacing, how wide they got the offense spread, and then the spacing within that. That's why we're seeing the success of the bigs receiving the ball on the high post or low post, and they're wide open.
Yeah.
But it's just for a flash, so you gotta catch and then make your decision, shoot or pass right away.
Jorgensen with the ball. She tried to put a little elbow into the stomach of Rawolf down there.
Look at Opel, just focused on D.
Knocked away by Tempest. She's going to have a breakaway. Goes up with the right hand. Puts it in off the glass, and she finishes through contact. No foul, though.
Oh, boy, she had a defender in her hip pocket.
Jorgensen from way downtown. Nylon. Wow.
Are we surprised?
From the N on the NCAA logo.
Actually, yeah, that was Heidi Jorgensen. Yeah, not Marsh, but still beautiful shot.
Jensen. Oh, great scoop pass. Fouled from behind. Great scoop pass by Bonnie Jensen to Natalie Rawolf. And Rawolf went up with the shot and was blocked from behind, but it was a foul call.
Ripon's game today, I mentioned it earlier, the best way I can think of it, on both ends of the court, they're just like a step ahead.
It is.
Of Cornell.
Checked in for the Redhawks is number 40, Sophie Schlieve, the freshman out of Anago, Wisconsin. Also checked in is number 10, Anna Farney out of Winneconne.
Yeah.
And Rawolf knocks home both free throws.
Schlieve, in the short time that she's getting on the court as a freshman, she's got nice, soft hands.
Yes, good, she does.
Good court awareness, too.
Good touch around the rim.
Yeah.
Almost let Buffington get behind her. She caught her in time before the pass could go. March working on Rawolf. Gives it to Aaron Jackson. Aaron Jackson with the right hand. Gives it right back
Jensen.
To Opel. Jensen's up there. Opel gives it to Jensen. And one! Bonnie Jensen! What a move! Rolls it in, did some magic with the spin there.
First of all, for Jensen to knock, I think it was her that knocked the ball away.
Yeah.
And then got on her high horse and ran that left wing.
Beat Opelt down the floor, and the only thing I could say about that play was that Opelt may have waited a little too long to pass it.
Yeah.
But other than that, now, great play on both ends.
Well, yes and no. They generally tell you make the decision by the on the fast break as we get another turnover on Cornell on a zig and a zag and a timeout by Cornell. On that play that we're talking about on the bust out on the 2-on-1, they normally tell you fundamentally the person with the ball either shoot or pass by the time you get to that free throw line. And you're right, they were deeper than that, but the defender hadn't really committed. She was between the two, and then at the last second she commits to the ball and then the bounce pass to her teammate. Fun to see. And I tell you, for Brassy to bring a team in here and for them to be handled the way they are right now with 4.5 minutes left in the third quarter, in all the years I've been doing this, I'm not used to seeing this. And it's not all Cornell, believe me. Ripon's playing certainly one of their best complete games that I've seen them, because even in games where they've won double digits that we're covering this season, you look at one stat and one of them is turnovers. And turnovers really create, at times, it's like, oh, wow, you got to cut that down, because when you come up against a stronger opponent, it's gonna cost you the win.
And it's funny because Ripon is losing the turn was losing the turnover battle at the end of the first half.
Yeah.
They were losing it by six.
Yeah, I saw that.
But
too.
The other thing that comes into play there is time of possession. If Ripon has the ball longer, the amount of turnovers really doesn't matter because they'll still have more time to capitalize.
Well, there you go. And we saw how many times in the first half Cornell shot to Ripon's. Ripon was so much more efficient.
Ravel almost traveled there.
Yeah, a zig and a zag.
Gets it in down low to Jensen. Jensen gets it out to Rawolf. Rawolf, baseline jumper, no good. Caught by Jensen. Pass out. Opelt thought about the three. Everyone on the bench did, too.
Never touched the rim, so they got to hurry the shot now.
5 seconds left on the clock. Rawolf from three, no good. And a loose ball foul. Loose ball foul is going to go on number 14, Bonnie Jensen.
Yes, our Martin Luther High School grad.
Her second foul of the game.
14 points to go along with her jersey number on the night for Jensen.
There you go. That's my lucky number. Here we go.
Personally, mine's 12.
Okay. We're in the neighborhood.
Yep.
Hey, 12 is, look who wears 12 for Cornell.
Gally March.
You bet. Nice left-hand finish off the glass for Cornell. They're up by 20 with under 4 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Talked about how important it is in the second half with teams when you come out, how well do you play? Well, Ripon has answered the bell big time in the second half.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have indeed. Gets it to Jensen. Jensen from three-point land. No good.
Yeah.
Oh. You know, and a foul. I don't know when the foul was. That was a late whistle if it was on any of the other two.
If Anna Farney would have a bumper sticker on her car, it would be one word, defense.
Yes, it
She's
would.
She's made it very clear, this being her junior year, and I remember her. She was a scorer, of course, in high school when Winneconne was at Ripon, taking them on in those games, a former Wolf. But it's defense is how she's gotten earned her court time from my observation.
Oh, 100%. Defense wins games and championships in basketball especially.
Here we go. They got the mismatch.
And a foul on Abby Hartman out of Wonder Lake.
Going to say some body there. Ripon up 44-24, 3:02 remaining in the third.
The one thing I will say about Adewusi, she knows how to work her body down low when she gets in the paint.
Well, yeah, she's very comfortable. She uses exactly, she'll use her back on her spin move to ward off the defender and then try to use the glass on the follow through of the shot, create contact, and you can see the result.
Rawolf is checked out as she hits the first free throw.
You know, Rawolf, you know, she's one of the leading scorers on the team. It's not going to show up today offensively, but if you watch this game today, her and Opelt both have played marvelous basketball.
Trying to work it down low, gives it to Tempest. And
yeah, bounce pass against the double team, got it stolen.
Aaron Jackson thought about the corner three. Now takes the long two. That's going to be short, way short.
Yeah. That arc made it rain.
Opelt looking for an open teammate. Drives to the left, looking. Finds Hartman. No, Farney over there. Gets Tempest in the middle of the lane. Right hand. No good. Grabbed by Hartman.
Look at Marsh. She read that.
I thought Hartman got hit a little bit as she went to make that pass.
She might have. This is where the officiating has to stay locked in.
Yep.
Not on the scoreboard.
2 minutes left in the third quarter. Redhawks lead by 19. Aaron Jackson from three. Nylon.
Nice looking shot right in front of her coach.
That'll earn some more minutes. And that's going to be a timeout by Busilaki.
Good timeout. We talked about that with Coach Finko in the game one. You got a double-digit
Stop
lead.
Momentum.
Momentum, absolutely. So with 1:47 left in the third, Ripon up 44-28. We're going to be back here Wednesday. We'll be broadcasting when Martin? When Beloit comes to town. It'll be the men playing first at 5:30, and then the women's game to follow at approximately 7:30. And Beloit College, the women's team, they are in sixth, but they're 5-5. You're in sixth place, but you're only two games out of second place in the win in the loss column. That's how tight it is. This is turning into a food fight. And if Ripon can hold serve today, what's going to happen with Cornell? Let's say they have a record of 6-4. Well, they're going to be in with Knox that right now is 5-4 and should win. They'll be 6-4. Grinnell and Lawrence are already 6-4. And Beloit should win. They're idle today, Beloit. Here we go.
Great pass to Hartman, who now barely gets it back out to Havlovitz. Great pass from Havlovitz, and Bonnie Jensen kisses it off the glass with the right hand.
How was the inside-outside game working? They came out of a timeout. Buzalaki's feeling really good about her ball club right now.
This is working to perfection for the Lady Redhawks.
It really is. Inside out. There's Marsh. Look out for her.
Grab by Awusi. Oh, nice, and a nice job. Play. It's going to be ripping ball. And a very animated Cornell bench for being down 18 points with a minute in the with a minute left in the third.
In the third. A lot of basketball to be played. So Cornell.
Going to get it into Kavanaugh. Almost got it picked by Hartman. Kavanaugh from three, no good. Rebound to Van Dresser. Van Dresser tried to go baseline. Stopped instantly by Jensen. Taken away on the ground were Tempest and Jensen.
Wow.
Havlovitz working, going up. Nope.
You stop and hesitate. Got lucky that Tempest picked
Forney.
It up.
Nope. Hartman rebound. Havlovitz with the ball.
The pressure intensifying on the ball.
Gets it down to Jensen. Right hand. Put it up and in.
Bonnie having a wonderful game. Tempest with a lot of scoring at halftime, almost a steal. Talked about Farney's defense laying in the weeds.
Both Jensen and Tempest, both with 16 points each. And I would imagine, if I'm looking at it right now, Tempest could be approaching a 20-20 game. Could be. We are not certain yet.
Nice knocked away
Simmons
by Hartman.
Gives it up.
Hartman knocked it out.
Havlovitz bringing it down. Hartman, rejected by Simmons. And that's the end of the third quarter. Redhawks lead 48-28 over the Cornell Rams.
Woo. So, you know, talking about how Ripon gets that lead back up to 20, but I was talking earlier, after three quarters earlier this week, Ripon was down, they were down by 13, Cornell. They came back and outscored Knox 20-7 in the fourth quarter, sent the game into overtime. Now, they came up just short and lost that game, but my point being, this is what Cornell is capable of doing. So Coach Buzalaki knows this, and she's got to be really pleased of the way in the first three quarters Ripon has played today, but you got to finish the deal. So that's what Ripon's job is. And Brassy realizes that, you know, the sports is about competition, and it's about playing to the end of the game. They're going to be playing hard because with the advent of the three-point shot, and if they can do defensively what Ripon has done to them in the fourth quarter, who knows? I've seen stranger things happen.
This game is not completely out of reach yet. To say it would be an easy comeback to make would be out of the question.
Yeah.
It is not easy by any means.
Yeah.
But it is also completely insane to say that Ripon already has this game won.
Oh, yeah. Now, by the way, back on December 6th, Cornell lost to Grinnell by single digits. This Wednesday, it's going to be Cornell at home versus Grinnell. Here we go.
Barely saved it, Callie March.
Yeah.
Into Adewusi, guarded by Tempest. No good.
Kevin
Tempest
McHale
with another
step.
Rebound.
Yeah.
Kevin did it better.
Oh, he even vented it.
And a foul is going to be. Oh, he originally called a foul.
Well, Tempest got her arm grabbed, her wrist hooked. They're letting them play. So it stays with Ripon. Possession arrow. Strong with the ball. They're doubling the ball every chance they get. I wouldn't dribble into the tee. Oh, what a pass.
Oh, Jensen grabs her own rebound and puts it back up.
Coach Brassi wanted, he thought what the referee was indicating when the Cornell player went to the ground was it was a flop.
No flops here.
No, that's what the sign was by the ref. Brassi didn't seem too upset with it. I think he saw it as well.
Gets it into Adewusu, looking. Tempest guarding.
Blocked
away by Jensen, not in her house.
Look
deep
at this.
Deep pass to Jensen. Defense, instant offense.
Well,
it all correlates.
You knock the ball away from this on the shot. You block the shot, and then you get on your high horse, and you're the recipient of the breakaway layup.
Bonnie Jensen might be one of the quickest post players down the floor I've ever seen.
Yeah, I've always talked about her through the years, about her just for a 5'11 big, the way she handles the ball. But, boy, her scoring. Marsh, hesitation dribble, just undressed the Ripon defender, froze him. She had that. Her crossover and Marsh's fake crossover are as good as anybody in the conference at the guard position.
Gets it into Jensen.
There's that inside-out game again.
Jensen just recently with that last basket hit the 20-point mark.
The entry pass by Tempest was knocked away and stolen by the Rams. Marsh now dribbling out on top. Their enemy now at the 7.5 minute mark is becoming the clock. Knocked out of bounds by Jensen.
Again,
complete
she is
games.
All over the place. All over it.
Complete games. Yeah. Nice job.
I'd imagine Tempest in his last 7.5 minutes is going to try hard to get to the 20-point total herself.
Well,
she's at 16 still. March. Gets it into Jorgens. No, Van Dresser. Buffington.
Ooh.
That was another
knocked
walk.
Knocked away by
Raul. Again knocks it away. Tempest gets it to Raul.
Ripon's in no hurry. But stay in that spread offense. You got your two bigs, one on the block, one on the post.
Great pass. Havlovitz. Oh,
you
got it knocked away.
Yeah. Caught it in the legs, too, by the way, defensively. So, feeding down the lane line, the big
Buffington.
Spin move.
Buffington, oh!
Wow.
I don't know about that one.
Well, yeah, you know, I always talk about this, whether if I'm doing a high school game, whether Ripon High School is up or down, I just notice this with the officiating, if one team is ahead of the other one big, it's like the officiating changes.
Yeah.
And maybe that's just the way it is, and it's hard to prevent.
And Bonnie Jensen's third foul, she's getting checked out of the game. She got a nice hand from the crowd.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
As she deserves.
I think I have to say here, even though Ripon took care of Monmouth, I look at where Cornell was coming into the gym today. I think overall this is the best effort I've seen by a Buzalaki team this season here in the Wilmore Center.
Havlovitz gets it right to Tempest. Beautiful work.
Yeah.
Drew almost the whole defense over to the left side of the court, and that left Tempest wide open for the inbound, for the dump in.
And the beauty is Tempest fundamental there. Didn't take the dribble, didn't put it on the floor. Pivot, turn, shoot. Score.
Knew how to do it.
Yeah.
And she knows how to work down low.
Tempest guarding Aaron Jackson. And again, another kick ball by Ella Tempest.
Yeah, we're below 6 minutes as Hartman for Ripon's now going to enter.
She's going to enter for Natalie Rawolf.
Rawolf, first year as a starter. The Madison Memorial grad has been very, very impressive to me this season. I had no idea what kind of scorer she was. And dribble drive, very impressive.
Good defense on Callie March by Ripon this whole game. Even though she has the
leading score.
Points,
yeah.
It's not as bad as it could be.
Yeah, they're going to call the rub by Havlovitz for Ripon. That's her third. No, that's her first. I was looking at the number prior to this foul.
She's got to get it in.
Almost out of
bounds. Oh, the teetering act by Van Dresser.
Held ball. What
held
an effort.
Ball, and that's going to go to the Rams.
What a great job. You're on the ground. You reach in. When she went to her left, the help defense. Outstanding today by Ripon. What a tough Ripon ball club. Oh, look at that. Barney. Just
Ripon basketball again.
You know, the anticipation and the rotation on defense has just been outstanding all day long. If you're a Redhawk fan, you've enjoyed this one. Approaching 5.5 remaining in the game. Ripon up 54-32. Yeah, keep that ball high.
Look for Tempest again. Look for Tempest again. Somehow Cornell ended up with that basketball.
Yeah, sometimes the passes are telegraphed by Ripon.
Yeah.
One thing they can fix. They never let the ball screen get set. And I say they, pretty much in basketball in general.
Yeah.
The screener... Oh, there's a
Callie March throws one up and one. Wow.
Opelt with the foul. They just sometimes, the person with the ball that's going to receive the screen, they get ants in their pants and they take off too soon. And there is your problem. And then the screener tries to readjust the screen because his teammate or her teammate took off too soon. And then they get called for a moving screen or the screen never gets set. You don't accomplish anything. Tempest, what a wonderful job.
She, 18 points. She more than likely might not be in the rest of this game.
And she probably not. And then she had her double-digit rebounds at the half.
I would not be surprised if Ella Tempest finished with 20 rebounds plus in this game. She had an equally as impressive first half as she did second half.
There's that high post. Inside out again.
Gets it down low to Hartman.
Get out of there.
Oh, I think that was a too early whistle.
I think the ref, I think you're right, and I think the ref was trying to avoid a scrum. Solano will enter. Lanny Havlovitz doing a great job today running the show. Point guard, the freshman from Wild Rose High School, Wisconsin. The freshman... Kylie Idris is in for Cornell. Look at that crossover by Idris.
Tosses one up to Owusu. Or
Mr. Shot. Knocked down the three on the offensive rebound and kick out to make it 54-38. Opelt brings the ball down for Ripon. Coach Busolaki is going to take a timeout. She's grabbing her white marker board. They're going to go over some things. So, like I said, Cornell will be home on Wednesday taking on second place Grinnell. They lost to Grinnell on December 6th, Cornell did. Meanwhile, Ripon will be home. We'll bring you that game Wednesday evening, men at 5:30 against Beloit College, the Buccaneers of Beloit. And then the women will follow at approximately 7:30 Wednesday evening. And that's what's going on there. So while the men, you have a few teams fighting to get into that third and fourth spot with six games remaining for most teams, the women's is much more bunched up. It is a traffic jam. It is Cornell's probably going to be 6-4. Then you're going to have Grinnell and Lawrence that are both 6-4 going into today. Both those teams should win. And then you have Knox at 5-4. And then you have Illinois College and Beloit College at 5-5. So we're talking six teams in the women's division for the Midwest Conference play. The only place that's definitely got it figured out is Ripon. They're going to go to 10-0. But second, third, and fourth place, those last three spots, six teams fighting for three spots. It's like musical chairs.
It's high drama.
Yeah.
4 minutes left in this ball game. Ripon leads by 16 points over the Cornell Lady Rams.
I'm going to be interested to see if Solano shoots a three.
Maybe.
If she gets a chance. Up, pass, tipped away. Fake a pass, make a pass, Vanessa.
Yep.
Good help by Solano. Knocked down a three.
Number 33, Kenzie Nielsen out of Peoria, Arizona.
Solano doubled the ball on the freshman point guard, and then she couldn't recover to the corner in time.
Oh, and Tempest and Jensen and Raubwolf will both be checked. Will all three be checked in, along with Havlovitz. This is no doubt to get Tempest the opportunity to go for 20.
No, I don't think so. I think this is 54-41, 3.5 minutes, 3-point shots. They're heating up.
That's true.
And she respects Brassy.
That's true.
I think she respects Brassy. I'll guarantee you, I don't think the head coach has any idea what points are right now.
That's fair enough. Raubwolf from three, nylon!
I think the assistants do, for sure. The field general, the head coach, they're orchestrating their teams.
Ooh.
Nice.
Knocked away by Tempest. She's on the breakaway.
What's this? Oh, lost the handle.
Oh, man, that's going to be a double dribble.
Yeah. You're coming down in there. You're now past the three-point line. You're thinking, okay, what are my options here?
Yep.
What am I going to do?
Oh, no.
Believe me, I assure you, I've been there.
We all have. It's basketball.
So, I think, you know, before Ripon scored here, you make another three here if you're Cornell.
We're in this game.
3 minute mark? Yeah, it's not over. And then you got to hope Ripon gets really cold at the free throw line. But they're taking too long to get a shot off. That's give credit to Ripon defense.
Havlovitz gets back up, and Adewusi gets fouled. She'll go to the line to shoot two.
Yeah, Havlovitz. What the one thing that I've been impressed with, but they haven't been able to take advantage of it, is the mismatches on the switches coming off of the ball screens by Cornell. And so they haven't been able to take advantage of their bigs against defensively the smaller guards for Ripon getting caught in the switches.
Adewusi knocked in her first free throw. Let's see if she makes her second.
Uh-huh.
No. Opelt bringing it up down the floor for Ripon.
Yeah, if you're thinking about getting back into this with the 2.5 minutes left, and if you're Cornell, I don't think you can sit back defensively. You got to come out on him.
Give it to Tempest. Let her go to work.
You got to go for the steal.
Tempest is going to go to work. Throws one up wildly.
Well, what they're doing, they're taking the legs out of the player. Yeah. Good help.
Oh, no, Havlovitz is down. Havlovitz is hurt. Knocked away by Havlovitz. Havlovitz is limping momentarily. Oh, and it's a foul on Ella Tempest.
Well, I just hope it's not that knee. That's all I'm going to tell you.
Havlovitz is...
She's in pain.
She is in serious pain.
She's in pain. The good news is she's moving.
She's being tough about it.
Yeah.
You could see she was almost in tears on the court. So she's definitely in some serious pain. She's being aided by a trainer over on the sideline.
You know, and Brassy also understands that, you know, we could be back here on the 23rd of February in the tournament And we want to also finish this game. Forget the scoreboard. We're going to finish tough, right?
Yeah.
We're going to finish tough. We're going to play hard. We're going to play right to the end.
Havlovitz down on the end of the bench getting talked to by a trainer.
Yeah. It's the left ankle, it would appear, which is good that it's not the right knee.
Yeah.
So those are the games that are up. So just let me once again share with you what's going around the conference today. You have Knox that's currently in fifth place. They were at Monmouth today. They're going to win that game. They go to 6-4. Then you have the game to watch today. Grinnell, which is tied for third, is at Illinois College, which is 5-5. And Grinnell is 6-4, just the one game difference. And then Lawrence, they're 6-4, but Lawrence is going to beat Lake Forest today. And Beloit, that's 5-5. We're idle today, so Beloit did not play in the contest. So I think I made it multiple times pretty clear that the women's basketball in Midwest Conference is going to be just nuts these last games of the season as we wind up the month of January heading into February.
And I don't think we'd want it any other way here.
No, especially if you're going to go to 10-0 and you're ripping.
Yeah.
Below 2 minutes remaining, 57-44, pressure being applied by Cornell. So, like I said earlier, this is going to come down to how does Ripon shoot free throws to finish off this game.
100%. Opel to inbound. Got to get it in. Gets it to Farney. She
nice
was hammered.
Job. Nice job. Yeah, it's that psychological thing I was telling you about earlier, my opinion about the game of basketball.
If you're a Ripon fan, you want to get the ball to Tempest to see if she can go for 20. But other than that, you kind of just want to hold it, see what goes. Opel took a shot there. No foul, though. March. Travel.
Coach Brassi's calling the ref on it. Called the travel.
Opelt bringing it up past half court now. Look for Tempest.
Good job.
Jensen does. Gives it right back to her. Oh!
Overlaid. Got her own. Stripped.
Grabs it again. Gives it to Tempest. Goes up.
Oh, okay.
No.
So what happened was Coach Buzalaki called a timeout to save the tie-up. But she's not a forecaster of into the future, so she didn't know that Jensen lying on her back was going to hit Tempest for an easy
that
deuce.
That was going to be 20 for Tempest.
I know that's where you were going with this, but I don't know if the foul situation, if she would shoot that or not.
That happened to me one time. I had 19 points in a game one time, and I hit a three. And all of a sudden, the ref waved it off and said one of my teammates was a three-second violation, and I almost lost it on my teammate. I'm like, yeah.
Hey, he's thinking, you should have shot it earlier. I was there to get the offensive putback.
Knowing him, yeah, that is what he was thinking. It's his birthday, by the way. Happy birthday, Storm.
Hey, by the way, I want to thank the guys working for us today.
Oh, yeah.
And we'll get to that with this conclusion of this game. Running their offense.
Work it to Tempest. Whoa.
Oh. Wow, that's a different one.
And Dresser just took a shot to the stomach from that pass. Well, not pass. Knocked away again.
Ripon going to go for
knocked
some
away.
Steals himself.
Tempest, there it is. 20 for Ella Tempest.
Good for her. And she stole it, and she scored with it. And we're going to get just a real quick substitutions here. That's why the timeout was called by Coach Buzalaki.
And I think that's going to be the final nail in the coffin here. Ripon up by 15 with 41 seconds left in this ball game. Tempest is going to, everyone's going to be subbed out. It's going to be a whole new five.
Wow.
22, Presley Buwalda. Number 23, Bree Miller. Number 40, Sophie Schlievy. Number 13, Maggie Gloss. And number 15, Molly Johannes. Johannes went to Laconia High School. Right
yeah, Laconia. And she's a good athlete in general.
Yeah. Seconds left on the clock. Ripon up 59-46. Probably going to dribble this one out.
Buwalda, the Randolph native. I bet you didn't know Randolph has a state record for...
I did not.
Tournaments, high school championships.
Actually, I think I did know that. Bree Miller from three. No good. Rebound from Schlieve. Puts it up. No good. Another rebound. A buzzer beater to end it. And the Ripon College Lady Redhawks win this one 61-46 as the Redhawks sweep the doubleheader. The men win 70-58.
Wow.
The Lady Redhawks 61-46.
Wow, wow, wow. I'm very impressed with the complete total effort today. I don't really see a weak point by this Ripon team today. They seem to, one of those games where everything comes together against a solid opponent that was in second place, and we'll have to wait at the conclusion of all the conference games today to see where everybody is. But I think there's going to be a log jam up at that second, third, and fourth positions. And we'll be back with you on Wednesday. We'll be carrying the Beloit game at 5:30 with the men, 7:30 with the women. I want to thank Patrick Cronin, the guy behind the lens doing the camera work today. Jim Soik working the, I don't know what they call this thing, but they always tell me, Martin, don't touch these controls. Stay away from the buttons. Don't look at the lights. Just stay away, and we'll trust you. Yeah. And Crete, a pleasure working with you today.
You too, Martin.
Yeah.
Once again, Ripon College, 61-46 over Cornell. They sweep the doubleheader against Cornell. Both the men's and women's team walk away with a W.
Yeah. If we don't work again, good luck in baseball this spring.
Thank you very much. Once again, Crete Slattery, Martin Ernser, Ripon College, signing off.